Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents To Lose a Battle, France, 1940, by Alistair Horne, narrated by John Lee. Preface to 1990 edition. The great Louis Namier once observed that history does not repeat itself. It is only the historians who repeat one another. Certain patterns of events, however, do recur, and it is the well-versed student of history, not least perhaps the military strategist, who can spot a familiar opportunity when it presents itself and grab the advantage therein. Hitler's triumphant campaign against France in 1940 remains a timeless textbook success of epic scale. Its lessons, properly assimilated and applied, enabled at least one other nation, whose people had, above all others, suffered so much at Hitler's hands, to save itself from overthrow and transform defeat into victory. In October 1973, the so-called Yom Kippur, or Ramadan, depending on the point of view, war broke out. Egypt took Israel completely by surprise, swarming across the Suez Canal and utilizing a secret weapon of powerful fire hoses, literally to melt away the high sand barriers that Israel had erected to protect her outnumbered defenders. For several critical days, it looked as if Israel would be defeated after suffering heavy losses among her armored units. Then, suddenly, to the world's astonishment, there was a remarkable riposte by Israeli mobile units which recrossed the Suez Canal and inflicted a decisive defeat upon the superior Egyptian forces. The Israeli army, which regards itself as being one of the best read in military history in the world and possesses its own publishing house, is carefully selective in printing only works that it deems to hold a direct bearing on Israel's survival. Thus, after the great success in the 1967 Six-Day War, I was gratified, but somewhat taken aback, when the Israelis purchased my book on the Battle of Verdun, 1916, The Price of Glory, for translation into Hebrew. The Six-Day War had been a staggering display of blitzkrieg-style warfare of the 1940 brand, and I found it hard to see just what lessons Verdun, that grim classic of static warfare, could hold for the highly mobile Israeli armed forces. However, when I visited Israel for publication of the book, it was explained to me most patiently that Israel, in the wake of 1967, was suffering unacceptable losses from Egyptian artillery bombardments along the Suez Canal, and the Israelis were currently studying all they could about the positional defensive battles of the First World War. I understood. In the ensuing years, the Israeli army, wisely, followed the German example of 1914 to 1918 as opposed to the French. Dig deep and hold your forward lines lightly. So when the Yom Kippur War of 1973 broke out, this correct assessment probably saved Israel, with its tiny manpower resources, untold casualties, if not the war itself. Now, it so happened that in 1971, 2 years before the Yom Kippur War, Israel's Ministry of Defense Publishing House had followed up by translating and publishing in Hebrew the third book of my Franco-German trilogy, To Lose a Battle, with its detailed account of the Manstein Plan, Sichelschnitt, which had given Hitler his blueprint for total victory in that summer of 1940. I thought no more about it. Then, when war broke out in October 1973, I was in Algiers, researching for my new book on the Algerian War, A Savage War of Peace. From Algiers, I watched with disquiet as the Egyptians swarmed back across the Suez Canal, taking the Israelis thoroughly by surprise. By not manning their front line with the bulk of their forces, as indeed the French army might well have done in either the First or Second World War, the Israelis saved themselves from instant defeat. Yet, after the first few days, it still looked as if, at best, Israel faced a costly stalemate, which, to her, would in effect equal defeat in the long term. But, out of the blue, Israel's dashing general, Ariel Sharon, launched a daring but carefully conceived counterthrust across the canal, striking on the hinge of two Egyptian armies and fanning out behind them with deadly consequences. Note, his reputation later became somewhat tarnished in the Lebanon. From what little I was able to glean from the press reports in Algiers, the Sharon action had elements that made it at once look amazingly familiar. It was a replay of Manstein's crossing of the Meuse in May 1940, and the military result was nearly as deadly. With one of its principal armies cut off, the Egyptians were forced to seek a ceasefire. Israel was saved. Some 2 years later, I encountered, at a London publishing party, Israel's leading military analyst and former chief of intelligence, Chaim Herzog. He was later to become Israel's president. We had met some years previously in Israel, and he had now just published his own account of the 1973 campaign, The War of Atonement, Weidenfeld, 1975. When I commented on the similarities to the Manstein plan of 1940, he smiled knowingly and said something to the effect that only recently General Sharon had referred to it, acknowledging a certain indebtedness to lose a battle. Herzog kindly signed a copy of his book for me, adding the laconic but meaningful inscription, "In appreciation." I retell this anecdote not in any intended sense of self-glorification, but simply to illustrate the point that sometimes the re-exploration of the past, the study of the lessons of old battles, is not always without profit. In the hands of the enlightened, perhaps history can be made to repeat, if not itself, then certain formulae. Anyway, it may be worth a listen. It is with this thought in mind that I re-offer this revised edition of To Lose a Battle for publication on the 50th anniversary of that cataclysmic year of 1940. This new edition contains some corrections and updatings. Since it was first published in 1969, numerous other books on the subject have appeared. When I wrote this book, nothing, notably, was known about the ultra-secret and its possible influence on the battle. Modern scholarship, too, has come round to a rather more charitable view of King Leopold and poor Belgium's impossible role in the fighting. Yet the basic ingredients remain the same. On the one side, a brilliant plan and a demonic will to conquer, chronic unpreparedness, muddle and demoralization, and an outdated concept of war on the other. The story and its lessons stand little changed. Preface to 1979 edition. When this book was first published, it was roughly 100 years since the Franco-Prussian War began, 50 since Versailles concluded the First World War, and 30 since the first act of the Second World War, the fall of France. It endeavours to tell the story of the last of these episodes. Although designed to stand firmly on its own feet, it represents the third panel of a triptych of which the other two were the fall of Paris, the siege and the Commune, 1870 to 1871, and The Price of Glory, Verdun, 1916, and is therefore closely linked to the theme of the earlier books. During most of this past 100 years, at least until 1945, the seminal issue in Europe was Franco-German rivalry. Now it is no longer so. As I tried to explain in the preface to The Fall of Paris, the original ambition of the triptych was to deal with this important chunk of modern European history, woven around three great Franco-German battles, each decisive in its own war, and in wider contexts as well. They are not essentially military studies. As the listener will discover from the present book, there are, at least in the author's view, various after-effects from both 1870 to 1871 and 1916 that have an important bearing on the French defeat of 1940. And so much that has happened since then is still happening can find an explanation in the debacle of 1940. In a number of ways, To Lose a Battle has been the most difficult to write of the three books. First of all, it was not easy to decide when the story begins and ends. To start with, the crushing superiority of the German Stukas and Panzers on the 13th of May 1940 leaves a lot unexplained, and the decisive battle was over long before Pétain asked for an armistice, even before the British Expeditionary Force embarked at Dunkirk. After I had finished my researches, I finally decided to begin with France's moment of supreme power, as seen at the Victory Parade of 1919, proceeding to deal with only those factors in the interwar world which seemed relevant to France's weakness and Germany's strength in 1940, and to end the main account with the failure of the last Allied counterattacks in northern France during the 21st to the 24th of May. After this date, for the Germans, the campaign was little more than a matter of marching. The second, and by far the greatest difficulty of all, concerned source material. The siege of Paris and the Commune together continued in the same setting for 9 months, Verdun for 10. Thus, in both battles, a multitude of chroniclers on either side had the leisure to provide detailed day-by-day accounts of what went on, often of superb quality. In 1870 to 1871, the historian is additionally aided by the presence, in Paris, of many neutral British and American observers, whose accounts provide a special dimension of objectivity. While for 1916, the official war histories of either side have long been open to scrutiny. In contrast, the decisive battle for France in 1940 lasted less than 2 weeks, but covered over 200 miles in depth alone. Many war diarists, especially on the French side, simply had no opportunity to write up their diaries or even scribble a letter home. From the German side, the Allied capture of all Nazi archives certainly provided historians with an unprecedented treasure trove. The French, on the other hand, have not yet published an official history of 1940, and the archives at Vincennes are not open to inspection. Note: the findings of such inquiries as the Serre Commission are at best only partially satisfactory. It is easy to understand the French reticence, yet one feels it may be prompted less by what is there than by what is not there. However, the lack of any French official history is in part compensated for by the plentiful personal accounts of participants granted access to the archives, such as Generals Dumont, Major General of the French General Staff, Roton, General Georges, Chief of Staff, and Roubye, Chief of Staff to the French Second Army, not to mention the lengthy memoirs by the leaders themselves, Reynaud, Gamelin, and Végan. But because of the pressure and speed of events, if for no other reason, such accounts are often in disagreement, and it is therefore not easy to determine what happened and when. For example, recording General Vaigon's crucial visit to the northern commanders on the 21st of May, both Baudouin and Churchill, neither of whom were there, write that Vaigon's plane was attacked and forced to land at Calais. Vaigon himself says he landed unchallenged at Nonfont, and then flew on to Calais. After the meeting, Baudouin says Vaigon left from Ypres at 4 p.m. by torpedo boat from Dunkirk to Cherbourg. Churchill says 7 p.m. by submarine to Dieppe, while Colonel Guttard puts the time at between 5 and 6 p.m. Churchill and others state that Lord Gort arrived too late at the Ypres meeting at 8 p.m. Benoit Méchain about 9 p.m. These may seem like hair-splitting points, but they make the historian cautious about accuracy on the bigger issues. Napoleon once warned, "Above all, be distrustful of eyewitnesses. The only thing my grenadiers saw of Russia was the pack of the man in front." Obviously, the advice can be taken too far, and Napoleon's grenadiers certainly saw more of the Russian campaign than he would have liked. But one has to be cautious about the fallibility of human memory. With one or two notable exceptions, such as the late Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Barrett, whose reminiscences proved invaluable to me, I have in general restricted myself to what was written at the time or very soon afterwards. Even here, however, one has to exercise caution. For reasons suggested earlier, I found myself forced to lean heavily on German eyewitness accounts of battle operations, such as the crossing of the Meuse. Some, such as Rommel, seldom let one down, even though at times he stole perhaps more than his fair share of the glory. But all too often, the National Socialist overtones of the moment, the vaunting of Teutonic deeds and deprecation of the enemies, never a reverse, never the sight of a burnt-out German tank, make one recoil in distrust. On the other hand, so many of the memoirs of French leaders are but one long apologia, although set against each other, they too can be revealing. Inevitably, there is much in this book that will be hurtful to French amour-propre. Although many of the studies emanating from France herself could scarcely be more scorching, the French, perhaps more than most nations, and particularly at this time of resurgent nationalism, tend to regard outsiders writing about their history as the voyeur who peeps through other people's bathroom keyholes. And, indeed, it is almost impossible for any Briton fully to comprehend the lingering wounds left by invasion and defeat in a nation as proud as France. Again, Dutchmen and Belgians, and my own countrymen too, may criticize me for dealing too briefly with their part in the Battle of France. Americans may feel that I should have said more of their role in the interwar period, and of the 1940 exchange of communications between Renault, Churchill, and Roosevelt. I can only excuse myself by repeating that this is, like the fall of Paris and the price of glory, primarily a story about France and Germany. Part 1. 1919 to 1940. Chapter 1. Grandeur and Misery of Victory. Note. Title of Clemenceau's Memoirs. 1919 to 1930. Victory was to be bought so dear as to be almost indistinguishable from defeat. Winston S. Churchill, The World Crisis. Youth could win, but had not learned to keep, and was pitiably weak against age. We stammered that we had worked for a new heaven and a new earth, and they thanked us kindly and made their peace. T. E. Lawrence on Versailles. 13th of July, 1919. Even on the Sunday afternoon preceding the next day's great event, crowds had begun to form along the Champs-Élysées. By 3 a.m. that night, an estimated 100,000 people had already taken up positions there. The Arc de Triomphe was unapproachable. Among the crowds, tempered by the presence of so many women still clad in mourning for a son or a husband, a tone of restrained, almost sober jubilation dominated. It was all very different from the August day of 5 years earlier, when frenetic Parisians had swarmed through the city singing the Chant du Départ and shouting, "To Berlin!" The janitors and charwomen had barely finished sweeping away the debris of diplomacy from Versailles' Hall of Mirrors, that great chamber where, in 1871, a victorious Prussian king had so arrogantly proclaimed himself Kaiser, and which, half a century later, France, with an unsurpassable sense of theatre, had selected as the fitting stage for the final act in the tragedy entitled Revenge. After more than 4 years of the most terrible war humanity had ever known, peace was now a fact. In London, as the guns boomed out the news that the treaty had at last been signed, loyal crowds had thronged outside Buckingham Palace to hear King George V say, "I join you in thanking God." But somehow, the discussions having dragged on so tediously, details of the treaty itself had already fallen a bit flat. The British public was as glad as the press to get back to more immediate and appealing topics. There were the first post-war Wimbledon and Henley, even though the Illustrated London News mourned that the latter was not quite itself this year. In Paris, especially, the signature of the treaty had swiftly become eclipsed by the imminence of this other, tangibly more magnificent, occasion. The 14th of July 1919 was the day of the victory parade, France's moment of supreme triumph, to many Frenchmen, possibly the greatest triumph in all her long history. Certainly never was there to be an occasion more fitting of le jour de gloire, celebrated by the Marseillaise, than this first 14 juillet since Alsace-Lorraine had returned to the fold from the 48 years of bondage. On the eve of the procession, a temporary cenotaph almost filled the mighty vault of the Arc de Triomphe. Note, the idea of burying an unknown warrior, selected from the remains of 8 fallen at Verdun under the Arc de Triomphe, was not conceived until later. Each of the 4 sides of the cenotaph was guarded by a victory, the wings of which had been fashioned from the fabric of warplanes. On the surfaces of its plinth could be read the somber dedication, "Aux morts pour la patrie." Throughout the night, flames of Greek fire smouldered and flickered from urns mounted at its angles, while powerful searchlights transformed its gilt plaster into gold. Surrounding the cenotaph, soldiers of all arms of the French army kept vigil with rifles reversed. They were watched by a silent and reverent crowd, perched upon or kneeling between the circle of captured enemy cannon drawn up around the Étoile. The 14th of July 1919. Shortly after midnight, the massive pylon was towed out from under the arch by tractors so as to enable the triumphal procession to pass through it, and established a short distance away. As the dawn, prefacing a day of silver and blue, broke, It recalled to some of the more romantic-minded French journalists the day of Austerlitz. A remarkable spectacle greeted the eyes of those lucky enough to have gained access to balconies high up on buildings flanking the Champs-Élysées. As far as the eye could see, down the green line of the Avenue de la Grande Armée and all the way along the 5 miles of the processional route, fluttered the flags and pennants of the Allied nations from an endless forest of white masts. On either side of the rond-point was heaped a huge mound of captured German guns, surmounted on one side by the Gallic cock of 1914, preening himself for the fight, and on the other by the victorious cock of 1918, crowing his ascendancy to the world. Down at the Porte Maillon, the resplendent masses of the Allied contingents were forming up behind their leaders, greeted by members of the Municipal Council, who, like the aediles of antiquity, were opening the city to the conquering armies. At 7:45 a.m., a car arrived at the Étoile, bringing Clemenceau, the dread tiger who, from the brink of defeat, had flogged France on to victory through the last desperate year of the war. Occasionally shooting fierce glances to right and left, the old tiger, followed by his inseparable lieutenant, a serious and pasty-faced young man called Georges Mandel, shambled slowly up to the official stand. Shortly after 8 appeared the President of the Republic himself, Raymond Poincaré, the man of Lorraine, a symbol of all that France had fought so gallantly to regain, his open car cheered along the length of the Champs-Élysées. Accompanied by France's two glorious marshals, Joffre and Foch, the President laid a wreath at the base of the cenotaph. The marshals then drove off to take up their positions at the head of the parade. As the President resumed his position on the tribune, cannon began to speak out in the distance, from the Bois de Boulogne, from Mont Valérien, from all the forts which, during the bitter winter of 1870, had endeavoured to save the city when besieged by the now humbled enemy. Rockets soared up and exploded over the Arc de Triomphe. Down at the Porte Maillot, a captain took out his watch and gave the order heard at so many lethal dawns during the preceding 4 years, Avancez! The drums rolled. The trumpets sounded out their fanfares in those peculiarly Gallic, almost querulously high-pitched notes, and approaching the Arc de Triomphe was soon heard the music of the regimental bands playing out the stirring strains of Vous n'aurez pas l'Alsace et la Lorraine. An electric sense of expectancy rippled through the crowd. All the fatigue of the long wait evaporated. The chains which had encircled the arch ever since the day when, 48 years ago, the Prussians had engraved perpetual hatred in French hearts by insisting on their rights to a triumphal march through the prostrate city, had been removed. Now, for the first time since that day of shame, marching men began to appear through the sacred arch. But those who led the way across the threshold in this historic moment, they were not Joffre or Foch, not the cavalry or the Zouaves or any Allied detachment. They were three young men, or what remained of them, unspeakably crippled by war, still in uniform, but trundled by their nurses in primitive chariots, like the prams of deprived children. Immediately behind them came a large contingent of more grands mutilés. Officers and men of all ranks mixed together, many already in mufti, they marched, or hobbled, without precedence or any semblance of military order, 12 abreast. Hardly one had not lost an eye or a limb, and many bore on their chests France's most coveted decoration, the Médaille Militaire. The totally blind, some accorded the privilege of being ensign-bearers, came led by the one-legged or the armless, men with their destroyed faces mercifully hidden behind bandages, men with no hands, men with their complexions still tinted green from the effects of chlorine, men with mad eyes staring out from beneath the skull caps, which concealed some appalling head injury. Some were famous heroes, easily recognized by the crowd. Among them, identifiable by his immense stature, limped Sergeant André Maginot, already a well-known figure in the assembly, badly wounded at Verdun. With a painful, halting pace, the column moved by, down the Champs-Élysées to the stands specially set apart for them. As they passed a stand filled with 150 young Alsatian girls in national costume, flowers rained down upon them. For a brief moment, the terrible spectacle of the broken men was met with a kind of stunned silence. Then an immense cry, which seemed to spring from the very entrails of the race, arose from the vast crowd, a cry which was both a salute and a pledge. No one who watched the mutilés pass that day could be unaware of what they represented. Of the many thousands, more hopelessly maimed, lodged in hospitals across the country, which they would never leave, of the hundreds of thousands of other war casualties, only relatively more fortunate, to whom the future could hardly offer much, and who, in turn, would be able to contribute but little towards the reconstruction of their exhausted nation. But, above all, of the lost legions of men who had not returned at all from the martyrdom of the Western Front, either whole or crippled. From metropolitan France alone, these numbered 1,315,000, or 27% of all men between the ages of 18 and 27. No combatant nation, except for little Serbia, had a higher mortality rate, higher than Russia, higher than Germany or her allies. It was a fact which, so brutally brought home on this luminous day of victory celebrations, would never cease to haunt the nation. There was a long pause in the procession, as if to permit us to breathe or to dry our tears. Then came La Gloire itself. Accompanied by a thunderous roll of drums and fanfare of trumpets, a squadron of the magnificent Garde Républicaine rode through the Arc de Triomphe, and just 40 yards behind them rode Joffre and Foch. Up to the 11th hour, there had been some discussion as to whether Joffre, fallen from grace during the Battle of Verdun, should take part in the parade at all. Finally, Foch had settled matters by declaring with admirable magnanimity that unless Joffre rode with him, inter pares, he would not march either. So, here they both were, riding abreast, the man who had saved France on the Marne in 1914 and the man who had brought her to final victory in 1918. France resisting and France attacking. Each of the two leaders was wearing the uniform with which he had so long been associated, Foch, all in grey, with a kepi bearing three rows of oak leaves, Joffre, a portly figure in black dolman and scarlet breeches. Joffre, showing his age, seemed to be much moved by the vast crowds, which he repeatedly pointed out to Foch, as if surprised that they should still recognize him. Foch, rigidly upright in the saddle of his famous charger, Emir, his marshal's baton with its seven gold stars, firmly grasped in the right hand, resembled all that a victorious general should be. A few discreet paces behind, a position that had long become habitual, rode the neat and dapper figure of General Maxime Weygand, Foch's chief of staff. Then came the rest of the Allied Generalissimo's staff, including a Colonel Georges, who, like Weygand, would also be called upon to fill a role of dreadful responsibility 20 years later. Now it was the turn of the Allies. First, in alphabetical order, appeared the Americans with General Pershing at their head. Swinging along the route, they struck a Times correspondent as the finest American troops Paris has yet seen, and their marching is really perfect. As the bandsmen strummed out over there, something about the lilt of it reminded excited French ears of the jazz that was now all the rage in Paris. Next came the Belgians, followed, after a 5-minute interval, by the British, led by Sir Douglas Haig. As they bore past the colours of 200 regiments that had fought and bled in Flanders or along the Somme, the crowd showed its enthusiasm by taking up the refrain of Tipperary that France had got to know so well. Then followed Italians in state-coloured uniforms, little Japanese in khaki, Portuguese, Romanians, Serbs and Siamese, and men wearing French tunics of bleu horizon, men from the new nations who owed their existence to the Allied victory and who would in turn be abandoned by these same Allies within the next 2 decades, Czechoslovaks and Poles. So many armies had it required to overthrow the might of the German Empire. Yet one army was missing, one without whose aid the miracle of the Marne could never have occurred, and without whose allegedly bottomless reserves of men there would not this day be any victory celebrations. Russia, now sealed off from her former allies by revolution and civil war, and apparently forgotten. Once the initial restraint imposed by the somber overture to the parade had passed, the crowd allowed itself to go wild. As each national detachment marched by, a fresh gust of cheering broke loose. Against all orders, cavalrymen closing intersections hoisted girls onto their saddles to provide them with a better view. Children and young women flung basketfuls of flowers onto the triumphal way and garlanded the bayonets of the soldiers with green and gilded paper crowns, so that, as the morning went on, it seemed as if they were marching on a carpet of blossom. On this day, at least, there was nothing grudging in France's gratitude to her allies. But, understandably enough, it was the mighty French contingent, bringing up the rear of the parade, for which the spectators had preserved the power of their lungs. A solitary figure, riding through the Arc de Triomphe on a white horse, gravely majestic, tall and magnificent in a uniform of bleu horizon, the austere face even paler than usual, provided the signal for the opening of the day's great climax. Marshal Pétain, the commander-in-chief. Behind him followed the Poilu. He had led through the 10 months' hell of Verdun, had nursed through the mutinies which so nearly broke the French army the following year. From each of France's 21 army corps, a company of the regiment bearing the highest battle honours for gallantry had been selected to march in the parade. What a spectacle of triumphant glory they presented as they marched past, with the regimental music thundering out Sombre Meuse and the Marche la Reine, the battle hymns that had so stirred French hearts during the years of agony. Then came the little chasseurs, with their rapid pace and large, floppy berets, men who had borne the brunt of the first German onslaught at Verdun, resplendent-looking hussars and cuirassiers in their glittering breastplates, who had not really had much of a chance in this war, after the first mad carnage during the Battle of the Frontiers, marvellous-looking men from France's overseas empire, foreign legionnaires, ferocious Moroccan goums in turbans and flowing white robes, Algerian and Indochinese tirailleurs, coal-black Senegalese, with an alarming reputation for not taking prisoners, artillerymen drawing a battery of the famous 75s that had halted the Germans on the Marne, and a battery of the less elegant, stubby 155s that had played so vital a role in the defence of Verdun, airmen led by one of the few survivors of the legendary aces, René Fonck, bearing an ensign, marines in navy blue who, cheek by jowl with the Belgians and British, had anchored the line in the muddy swamp of Flanders. At various intervals came the victorious commanders, whom the crowd instantly recognized and applauded. Gouraud, the one-armed hero, Beau, also bearing an empty sleeve, but from 1870, Fayol and Debenet, Maistre and Manguin, once nicknamed by his troops the Butcher, and Castelnau, whose black brassard, recalling that he himself had lost 3 sons in the war, seemed to draw particularly warm acclaim from the stands. All famous warrior names, and in the recognition each received, those angry memories of the futile, costly offensives, the frightful reverses, the reproaches that the generals were wantonly throwing away the lives of their men, all these were submerged in this moment of sublime thanksgiving. But it was the men, not the chiefs, that the crowd were chiefly saluting, and particularly the infantry that made up the vast bulk of the procession. Wave upon wave they came, the renowned cutting edge and very substance of the French army, which had fought and endured, suffered and died, in the most unspeakable conditions ever imposed upon humanity. All through the war, from the first murderous clash on the frontiers, through Verdun and the Somme and the Chemin des Dames, to the second Marne and the final glorious advance of October 1918. As the crowd watched the tattered colours of the infantry regiments file by, a kind of delirium overtook it. There were many who began, quite instinctively, to sing La Madelon, with tears streaming down their faces. What thoughts, what memories were passing through the minds of the troops as they marched by the statue of Strasbourg in the Concorde, now disburdened of its mourning crepe, for the first summer since 1870? For in all French hearts, this 14 juillet was a day of destiny that had been dreamed about, not merely over the past agonizing 5 years, but for another 43 beyond them. Enough Frenchmen, both watching and marching, were sufficiently old to recall the shame of that defeat. Pétain, who, alas, would live on to act as caretaker for France under a new and still more humiliating defeat, had been a schoolboy, but Foch, as a youth, had witnessed Louis-Napoleon retreat sick and defeated through Metz, and Joffre had manned a cannon on the ramparts of Paris during the 4 months' siege. Clemenceau had been one of the deputies to protest against the surrender of Alsace-Lorraine in 1871, and had narrowly escaped being lynched in the civil war that followed with the Commune. But now, as President Poincaré had declared to him in a special message, in the light of this glorious morning, the last traces of the painful past have just been removed forever. For over an hour, the march past of the French contingent continued. It was hard to realize that, in the course of the past year, France had already demobilized nearly 3 million men. It was also pardonable for a Frenchman to believe, watching this magnificent cavalcade of his army, that France had won the war largely by her own efforts and losses. Finally, to close the procession, 9 of General Etienne's assault tanks rumbled through the Arc de Triomphe. The sulphurous smell of burning oil and the deafening roar and clatter that reverberated with their passage under the great archway seemed more a token of the potency of the French army of today than a harbinger of the battles of tomorrow. Who could have any doubts that France, emerging triumphant from the inferno, now possessed the world's most powerful instrument of war on land? What a day! What a spectacle! As the dust from tanks settled and the golden cenotaph was dragged slowly back under the arch, the thought impressed itself on one onlooker that a sight like this will never be seen again, because there will never again be a war. Light and Shadows. All through the night of the 14th of July 1919, revelers danced through the streets of a dazzlingly illuminated Paris, turning it, as the Times remarked, into one vast ballroom, hoping, believing that the euphoric vidus of pre-1914 would return, had returned. But somber spectres were already casting their deep shadows. For anyone who read the small print in the newspapers, they were apparent even before the feast began. On the previous Friday, there had been a disagreeable little incident at the Café de la Paix. It had been thronged with gay, chattering customers, including many Allied officers and their ladies, when a group of waiters on strike suddenly appeared on the scene, upsetting tables, breaking crockery and spilling drinks. Blows were exchanged between patrons and strikers, but the arrival of some 100 reserve police quickly restored order. The disgruntled waiters, it appeared, were striking for an 8-hour day and better food and working conditions, similar demands to those which, on the very day of the signature of the peace treaty, had brought about a metro and bus strike, paralyzing the city. That spring, inflation and the growing restiveness of the workers, la vie chère instead of la vie douce, had been the main topic of conversation in many a French household. Fortunately, or so it seemed to Parisian property owners, the government was being tough with these left-wing demonstrators. But its toughness was only embittering the atmosphere. It was clear that France, in giving her all for victory, had gravely neglected some aspects of her internal health. The Union Sacrée, that miraculous wartime truce between all parties and all classes, had barely survived the armistice. Then, on the very day of the victory parade, there had been disquieting reports from Berlin in the papers, telling of a street fight between wounded German ex-soldiers and some French officers. The affray had ended in the killing, by some unknown hand, of a French serviceman. It was a nasty reminder that the beast was still not quite dead. And meanwhile, from Washington, where the Senate was beginning its deliberations on the peace treaty, rumors were coming that President Wilson might yet have difficulty in persuading the American Congress to ratify the instrument that was to guarantee France, once and for all, against the menace of the beast. 4 months later, the dreadful rumors became reality. Left-wing dissent. In France, one important group had boycotted the victory celebrations. The political constellation of the far left, communists, internationalists, and extreme socialists. The recent war, in their eyes, had been but a criminal affair between the capitalist classes. The workers, in their millions, had died in it, but it had been no concern of theirs. And the war had not ended in a holy revolution, bringing the overthrow of the existing order, as had happened in Russia. Therefore, there was no cause whatever for rejoicing. Instead, the extremists had decided to stage their own show. Together with some disabled ex-servicemen, about 100 strong, they gathered near the Place de la Trinité. Note. Despite exhortations, the vast majority of the left appear to have been lured away by the greater attraction of the victory parade. As a macabre demonstration against militarism, they had intended to roll several of the mutilés in their invalid carriages in front of Foch's horse as he rode past the Opéra. But they were forestalled by the police and dispersed. Reforming on the exterior boulevards, they then march through the east end of Paris to pay tribute to the Communard martyrs enshrined at Père Lachaise Cemetery. There was a scuffle at the cemetery, and some 20 arrests were made. The next day, Marcel Cachin, editor of L'Humanité, blazed forth in vituperation against the victory parade. Bitterness, disgust. I have recognized the crowd. It is not the crowd that took the Bastille and sang for the first time of liberty in the streets. It is not the crowd that religiously followed the bier of Zola or Jaurès. It is the brutish elemental crowd which does not change, which slavishly acclaims Caesar and Boulanger, which yells at the vanquished, which chooses its heroes indifferently among boxers, gladiators, and captains. Cachin's ire may well have been fanned by the poor turnout of his supporters on the 14th, but their small numbers that day were deceptively irrelevant to the intrinsic, let alone the potential strength, of the new left in France. For in none other of the victorious nations had Russia's October Revolution evoked stronger sympathies than among the workers of France, the home of revolution itself. It struck powerful chords with the ancient and deep-rooted revolutionary mystique of 1793, 1848, but above all with the Commune of 1871, the brutal repression of which remained stamped in the minds of the French left wing, and whose failure Lenin had now used as a textbook to perfect his own revolution. The foundation in March 1919 of the Third International in Moscow had revived hopes of successful revolution in the hearts of the spiritual heirs of the martyred communards, while it was no accident that among the interventionist forces in Russia, it was the French at Odessa who had raised the flag of mutiny. And at home, there was already abundant fuel on the economic and social scene for the flames of revolution to feed upon. From the very earliest post-war days, the presence of a potent new force on the French political scene was increasingly apparent, and the bourgeois property-owning classes closed their ranks accordingly. French illusions. With the armistice of 1918, a series of insidious illusions had pervaded France. Falling back on the eternal, rather arrogant dogma of it being civilization's implicit duty to come to the rescue, when necessary, of its fountainhead, she automatically presupposed that her Anglo-Saxon allies would henceforth never abandon her, that they, particularly America, would maintain their interest in reshaping Europe. But when President Wilson had come over to France to address the victorious doughboys about peace upon the foundation of right, they had shown themselves frankly bored. They wanted to get home, and the American electorate showed that it wanted to keep them there, forever. As the idealism of 1918 evaporated, so the Anglo-Saxon nations would retreat further and further into their shells. Even more than France, they would become preoccupied with their own pressing internal problems. Feelings would grow, particularly in Britain, that Germany had been treated with excessive harshness at Versailles. Feelings generated partly by honest altruism, partly by the dictates of commerce, but partly by instinctive concern at a victorious France's apparently annexationist tendencies, as revealed by her reaching out for the Saar and her sending troops into Germany's bankrupt and defaulting Ruhr. Another illusion, one to which the glory of the victory parade doubtless added impetus, was that France felt she had won the war largely by her own superlative exertions. But the British and Americans knew that it could not have been won without them, and they would soon feel that the price paid, both in men and gold, had been too high. They would do almost anything rather than risk having to save France a second time, let alone regain Alsace-Lorraine for her. Hand in hand with this illusion went France's belief that, primarily through the supremacy of her army, she could enforce the peace by herself. But she could not, because morally, numerically, and economically, the war had left her feebler than she realized. As the true state of France's economy became more widely apparent, so it became popular to cherish the happy, simple illusion that the Bosch will pay. But Germany could not, would not, pay. The Allies would not make her, and the effort to do so was to cost France herself too much. Finally, there was the mortal illusion, although certainly Foch, for one, did not share it, that vanquished, ruined, truncated, revolution-torn Germany could never again be a military menace. But had Frenchmen forgotten already how the harsh settlement imposed by Prussia in 1871, with its territorial amputations, had kept alight France's own fire of revenge for the best part of half a century? Would France, indeed, have been so ready to rush to the aid of her ally, Russia, in 1914, had Alsace-Lorraine not weighed heavily upon the balances? Now France's supreme grievance had been erased, but Versailles had simply transferred the burden to Germany, mourning her lost territories in the East. Financial stresses. Of all the sources of her illusions, probably the most consequential lay in France overestimating her own powers to mould the post-war world, an error that was to claim Britain, too, in the years following 1945. It was, in fact, a haggard France that faced the dawn of victory. The bare economic facts were daunting. France had expended some 25% of her national fortune. Almost 7% of her territory had been devastated by war, including some of the richest industrial areas. 3.25 million hectares, 12,500 square miles, or roughly the area of Holland, of fertile soil had been ravaged. 3,500 miles of railway and over 30,000 miles of roads were destroyed. Coal production was down by 37% compared with 1914, steel by 60%. The trade deficit had risen from 1.5 million to 17.5 million francs. France's Ministry of Finance estimated the material damage caused by the Germans, and which would be the basis for reparations, at 134,000 million gold francs, a staggering figure compared with 5,000 million which Germany had demanded and got from France in 1871. Yet, showing the same extraordinary recuperative capacity that had amazed the world in 1871, France, after 1918, repaired her shattered industries, and her courageous peasants got her rattled fields back under the plough far quicker than anyone could have imagined. It was to her financial structure, however, that the really lasting damage had been done. To pay for the war, France had ineluctably allowed inflation to have its head by issuing a flood of paper money. By the armistice, the franc had lost nearly two-thirds of its value. This was only a beginning, whereas it then exchanged at 26 to the pound sterling, 5.5 to the dollar. Already by the time of the victory parade, it had depreciated to 51 to the pound. By May 1926, its value had sunk to 178 to the pound. And finally, 2 months later, with a hostile mob beating on the gates of the Palais Bourbon, to 220. The causes were not hard to find. Fanned by the new virulence of the revolutionary left, the French workers' very justifiable demands for better conditions and higher wages to offset this wartime inflation gave the spiral an extra spin. Then there were the additional millions which had to be spent in paying the pensions of the legions of ex-servicemen, notably the mutilés. But the most pernicious influences here harked back to those two illusions, namely that France's allies would always be ready to help her and that the Boche will pay. By the end of the war, the public debt had reached 156,000 millions, of which 32,000 millions were owed to the United States and Britain. The budget of 1919 had been postponed more than 7 months, during which time further vast loans had been launched, so that when the budget was finally agreed, it showed an enormous deficit of 27,000 millions. Nobody viewed this too tragically. First, it was automatically assumed that the Allies would be accommodating and generous in the recovery of France's war debts. It was widely thought, in the words of a cynical expression popular at the time, that the Allies could not possibly expect France to repay the cost of overcoats in which her soldiers had got themselves killed. But Britain, for one, with nearly 1 million of her own men lying dead in Flanders fields, and with equally grave internal problems at home, did not quite see things that way. Hopes for reparations. When the budget had been postponed in December 1918, the Minister of Finance, Louis Lucien Klotz, according to Clemenceau, the only Jew who knows nothing about money, made it clear that he expected France's budgetary deficits to be redeemed then and thenceforth by German reparations. At the peace conference, France had estimated her total war damages at 209,000 million gold francs, while the overall claims of the Allies amounted to some 400,000 million. But British Treasury experts reckoned that the most that could be squeezed out of Germany would be 75,000 million. With the British showing marked distaste for the whole subject from the outset, most bitter discord had surrounded the talks on reparations at Versailles, a discord that certainly did not go unobserved beyond the Rhine. Finally, and fatally, the sum to be paid by Germany was left open for future negotiation. It was as an open sore that the issue of reparations remained open, gaining little for France but ill will. In 1923, Germany defaulted on her payments, and France occupied the Ruhr to force her to pay. Britain, seeing political ambition behind the financial pretexts, and indeed there were nationalist Frenchmen who openly expressed hopes that the occupation might prove permanent, dissociated herself. From the ensuing industrial breakdown resulted the final collapse of the German mark. Down in Bavaria, an angry, unknown Austrian acquired his first national publicity. Throughout Germany, a legacy of lasting resentment was created, as well as a few martyrs of whom Hitler would later make excellent capital. Relations with Britain became chronically estranged and would hardly regain their former cordiality before the eve of the Second World Crisis, while in France herself, the franc threatened to run after the Reichsmark. On being forced to retreat from the Ruhr, the illusion of France's power in the post-war world received its first serious shock. Reparations, with the international hostility they caused, did more than anything else to clear the way for the Second World War. They certainly did not result in balancing France's budget, as Klotz and his successors had hoped. In fact, out of all the international transactions intertwining reparations with the repayment of war debts in the 1920s, Germany probably gained more than France. During the first half of the 1920s, seven different ministers of finance, following on each other's heels, failed to put France's house in order. Although the return of Raymond Poincaré in 1926 brought France an almost miraculous three-year period of quasi-stability, as well as prosperity, in the 17 months after his retirement, in 1929, another five governments came and went. France's financial dilemma extended itself into the 1930s, bringing down government after government, rendering impossible any consistent foreign policy, let alone any policy of reconciliation with Germany, bedeviling the Third Republic throughout the remainder of its existence, and finally hamstringing it when the necessity to rearm confronted France with desperate urgency. Lack of men and ideas. The means by which Providence raises a nation to greatness are the virtues infused into her great men. So said Burke in his memorial to Pitt. By the end of the 1920s, it was painfully apparent that the political being of the Third Republic was suffering from a grave deficit of great men as much as it was of great ideas. Clemenceau had been rapidly dispatched, in much the same manner as the British nation was to deal with its warlord in 1945. Passé le péril, maudit le saint. Briand was tottering, Bainlevé aging, while in the same year that both Clemenceau and Foch died, 1929, ill health forced Poincaré from the political scene. After the ceremony solemnizing the liberation of Strasbourg in 1918, he had been heard to sigh, "Now I can die." Despite his own remarkable resurrection in 1926, the overtones of Poincaré's remark were loaded with a double significance. With the return of Alsace-Lorraine, the supreme motivating and uniting ideal had been removed from French politics. Where was there now a holy grail worth questing and fighting for? Balancing the budget was hardly a substitute. At the same time, Poincaré's sigh echoed the psychological lassitude that was increasingly to beset French politics, later to be compounded with the physical consequences of France's terrible war losses. For among these, the one category bled whiter than all the rest comprised the liberal professions. Of the total mobilized, 23% had been killed, the source which should have supplied the new Clemenceaus and Poincarés. In her autobiography, The Prime of Life, Simone de Beauvoir tells of a Dr. Lemaire who, on returning from the front, where he had operated on hundreds of wounded under the most sickening conditions, took to his bed and never got up again. How many of France's young intellectuals, lucky enough to survive the trenches and who should now be taking over the reins of government, had, like Dr. Lemaire, simply slumped within themselves, mentally and morally drained? The left-wing challenge, immediately following the end of the war, was succeeded in France by a brief phase of deceptive parliamentary stability. Thoroughly alarmed by fears of the Bolshevik menace, the bourgeois parties had rallied together to form a right-of-centre Bloc National Républicain. At the elections of November 1919, the Bloc swept into power, winning nearly three-quarters of the seats in the Assembly, and furnishing France with the most right-wing parliament she had known since 1876. Meanwhile, the left wing seemed to be tearing itself apart by internal divisions. During their Congress at Tours, in December 1920, the Socialist Party had split into the new Parti Communiste Française, uncompromising devotees of the Soviet Revolution, and the more moderate socialists, calling themselves the Section Française de la Deuxième Internationale Ouvrière, SFIO. This was followed, in 1921, by a similar split within the trade unions, from which emerged the dissident communist Confédération Générale du Travail Unitaire, CGTU, obedient to every instruction from Moscow and pledged to total war against management, in contrast to the more moderate line pursued by the old Confédération Générale du Travail, CGT. Until the Great Reunion, under the Popular Front of 1936, communist would chastise socialist. The CGTU would revile the CGT. Short-sightedly, employers and bourgeois rejoiced at this rift in the left-wing camp and were encouraged by its apparent weakness to backtrack on essential social reforms, thereby building up for the future an explosive reserve of grievances and ill will. Expressing his fundamental mistrust for the League of Nations, Clemenceau once remarked, "If you want to have a new spirit between nations, start by introducing a new spirit at home." In fact, post-war French politicians swiftly showed an instinct to return to the old spirit of the Third Republic, only worse. Before the war, issues had at least been relatively clear-cut and simple. Hardy perennials, such as anti-clericalism and the Dreyfus case, helped define boundaries between parties, and there was always the supreme polarizing force of Alsace-Lorraine. Now revenge, la revanche, was fulfilled, and anti-clericalism virtually a dead duck. Issues were blurred and complex, and there was this mounting shortage of strong wills and clear minds capable of guiding their parties in the search for a coherent program. Like amoebae, parties divided and redivided within themselves. Politicians became subject to the pull of the rapidly growing numbers of pressure groups, all acting upon Parliament. And for many, self-interest came, in the absence of any other grander motive, to be their guiding star. With the collapse of each successive government, it proved just that much harder, especially after Poincaré had gone, to create a majority with any promise of stability. A mad game of musical chairs ensued, to be played at a giddier and giddier rate until Hitler's panzers finally stopped the music. Though France's governmental instability in the 1920s was principally provoked by discord over internal matters, such as the budget, it was upon her external policy, particularly towards Germany, that this had the most baneful effects. The overriding practical purpose of the Versailles Treaty had been to guarantee the security of France, to prevent her from ever again being swamped by the Teutonic hordes. To this end, the Germans were required by the treaty to disband their general staff, to reduce their army in perpetuity to a militia of only 100,000 men, and forbidden tanks, heavy artillery or aircraft. Under the separate treaties of Saint-Germain and Trianon, the Habsburg Empire had been broken up into a row of small nations, so as to deprive Germany of any powerful potential ally in Central Europe, and it was hoped that these Poles, Czechs, Yugoslavs, Hungarians, and Romanians would all show their gratitude by remaining constant allies of France. By augmenting French industry at the cost of Germany's, it was reckoned that reparations would help erase the traditional disparity between the economic power of the two countries. Finally, to secure her vulnerable eastern frontier, France had been granted a footing in Germany's Rhineland. But here she had got less than she wanted. Foch had declared, "If we do not hold the Rhine permanently, no neutralization or disarmament or any kind of written clause can prevent Germany from sallying out of it at will. In the future," he added prophetically, "there would not be time for the arrival of Anglo-American aid to save France from military defeat." But Lloyd George and President Wilson had thrown up their hands in horror, exclaiming that they could not countenance annexations by France that would only create another Alsace-Lorraine. In the end, France had had to be satisfied with the permanent demilitarization and a temporary occupation of the left bank of the Rhine. Note, in fact, the last French soldier left the Rhineland in June 1930. Foch boycotted the signature of the treaty, grumbling in disgust and with some accuracy, "This is not peace. It is an armistice for 20 years." As the realities of the post-war world proceeded systematically to destroy France's illusion that she was capable of maintaining the peace of Europe, so her leaders were beset by mounting anxiety that the provisions of Versailles could at best offer her only partial and temporary security. In the background there stood constantly the one unalterable fact of life from which they could never avert their gaze. Even with the addition of Alsace-Lorraine's 1,800,000 inhabitants and the effects upon Germany's population of her territorial losses, there were, in 1919, still only 39 million Frenchmen, compared with 59 million Germans. Moreover, Germany sustained a vigorously expanding birth rate, whereas that of France was static, so that even by 1931, she had still barely made good her war casualties. This was the one fundamental constant factor at the back of France's European policy throughout the 1920s and into the 1930s. But because of her chronic state of governmental instability, she found herself incapable of facing this problem with any consistent strategy of her own. One moment, she would show herself bent on grinding down the Germans by marching into the Ruhr. The next, she was offering the olive branch of reconciliation. She would vaunt the supremacy afforded by the offensive might of the French army, then hide herself behind a 20th century Great Wall of China. She would appear to place her faith in the League of Nations, while with the other hand, she endeavoured to hem Germany about by alliances with the new East European buffer states, although it was all too doubtful whether any combination of these could ever replace the weight of the Russian behemoth, France's defaulting ally, now engrossed in the dream of Marxism and the nightmare of civil war. Even during the most hopeful post-war period of the Brion-Stresemann Entente, which stretched intermittently from 1925 to 1929, attacks from the right and lack of support on the left forced Brion again and again to renege on his declared aims of Franco-German rapprochement. Finally, in 1929, when Premier for the 11th time, Brion proposed, from the tribune of the League of Nations, a European federation embracing Germany. It was a grandiose ideal, a generation, alas, ahead of its time, and Brion was promptly overthrown by the French nationalists. Almost simultaneously came the death of Stresemann, the Weimar Republic's most inspiring and inspired leader, and possibly the one man capable of stemming the rising tide of Nazism. Shortly before he died, exhausted and disillusioned, Stresemann summed up his dealings with France. "I gave and gave and gave until my followers turned against me. If they could have granted me just one concession, I would have won my people. But they gave nothing. That is my tragedy and their crime." In actual fact, by the end of the first post-war decade, France had made substantial concessions. She had, for instance, agreed to withdraw her troops from the Rhineland 5 years ahead of the specified time. But her concessions were so hedged about with the reservations imposed by the waverings of her diverse governments that, in German eyes, they bore no signs of genuine magnanimity or forward-looking statesmanship. Rather, they seemed acts of weakness and irresolution, forced upon France by her dissident allies or by the force majeure of external events. As the 1930s opened, Brion lamented, with bitterness, that despite all recent concessions made on reparations, nothing had diminished Germany's ill will. By 1931, Germany was like the genie in the bottle, who, instead of showing gratitude to his innocent liberator, slew him by way of requital for his prolonged sufferings. Now, in the midst of France's perennial game of legislative musical chairs, there burst the malignant, irreconcilable figure of Hitler. Chapter 2. Thank God for the French Army. Against an army sailing through the clouds, neither walls, nor mountains, nor seas could afford any security. Samuel Johnson, Rasselas. Thank God for the French Army, cried Winston Churchill before the Commons on the 23rd of March 1933. It was 2 months after the coming to power of Hitler. Few statements by Churchill outraged even Tory opinion more than this one. All round the House, he observed looks of pain and aversion. For it was also the year in which, having reduced her own arms expenditure to its all-time low for the interwar period, Britain was urging France to follow suit. Preoccupied with the row over Larwood's bodyline bowling in the test match against the Australians, the yo-yo craze, trunk murders, and the amorous successes of the rector of Stukey, Britain had assumed a progressively detached attitude towards Europe's problems. Note, throughout most of 1932, the middle-aged rector of Stifkey, pronounced Stukey locally, had provided the British press with an unending source of anti-clerical entertainment through his escapades with battalions of teenage waitresses in London tea shops. Defrocked, he ended his career in a lion's cage in 1937, where he was billed to give a lecture. The lion objected. The emotional view of the Great War as a glorious crusade had been widely replaced by the doubts voiced by Lloyd George when he declared, "We all blundered into war," and France's role in leading Britain into this supreme blunder seemed to be illuminated with ever-increasing clarity. British public opinion, shocked at accounts by the spenders and issuewards of starving, ricket-ridden children growing up in a Germany, apparently broken by France's avarice for reparations, had, unlike the French, ceased to regard Germans as the eternal enemy. Note, the inverted attitudes of post-1945 make an interesting comparison. By and large, it had lapsed back into that normal, healthy Anglo-Saxon status quo ante of mistrusting all French designs, a spirit of the age which, as late as July 1934, the Times epitomized with its forecast, "In the years that are coming, there is more reason to fear for Germany than to fear Germany." It was the vision of the huge French army, still presumptively the most powerful in the world, constantly poised over European affairs, which alarmed Britons, among whom, in praising it, Winston Churchill stood for only a dissident minority. But, as Hitler began to make it abundantly plain that he would not rest until the diktat of Versailles was overthrown and Germany returned to her former ascendancy, what, in fact, was the state of the French army? Was it still the superlative weapon of 1919? The influences of Verdun. The training and morale of an army, and even its weapons, are transient factors that can alter the balance between opposing forces within the course of one campaigning season. It is the more immutable matters of doctrine and fundamental strategy that require to be considered here. That a victorious army should, in its subsequent peacetime development, be strongly influenced by the experiences of the past war is a historical platitude, and only too natural. But, to quote Frederick the Great, "experience is useless unless the right conclusions are drawn from it." France, having borne so much of the brunt of the fighting on the Western Front, the experience there came to weigh with particular gravity upon French military minds. Predominant was that of Verdun, 1916, whence arose three separate influences, in many ways self-conflicting, but each vitally affecting the post-war French army. The first related to the psychological consequences of Verdun emerging as the symbol and legend of ultimate glory. In most of the great Allied undertakings of the war, the glory had been shared. But Verdun, the longest and most terrible struggle of them all, had belonged solely to France. For 10 agonizing months, and at a cost of over 400,000 men, she had measured herself in single combat against the full power of the German army and won. As well as epitomizing the very nature of the war itself, Verdun proved to be a kind of watershed in it, the walls upon which broke the supreme hopes of Imperial Germany, as President Poincaré declared. With every justification, Verdun at once became a legend of national heroism and virility. In the passage of years, it grew to be enshrined with the holy qualities of a miracle. It was France's Battle of Britain, symbolizing just as much though perhaps imbued with even greater emotive force and bearing the same kind of latent peril. Just as post-1945 Britons, perplexed by imperial disintegration and adversities of trade, found, and still find, unreasoned comfort in the belief that whatever divinity had presided over Dunkirk and in the London skies would always, in the end, sally forth to save them, so Frenchmen, to their peril, came to regard Verdun as a touchstone of faith in the jungle of the interwar world. In the army, as recurrent financial crises rendered the replacement of obsolescent equipment a constant nightmare, it was always agreeable to recall the fundamental superiority which the French warrior race had displayed over the now disarmed enemy in 1916. Just as the British Navy ossified after Trafalgar, a kind of conservative complacency was bred in France. What was good enough in 1916 is good enough now. To challenge it hardly guaranteed popularity in army circles. Yet, parallel to the first influence, a second contained the awareness of just how much warfare like Verdun had cost France. More regular officers and men of the French army had gone through the inferno of Verdun than any other battle, and the frequent post-war commemorations ensured that their minds retained the full horror of those 10 months. The ceaseless shelling from an enemy whom, very likely, one never saw, the wounded men agonizing untended, the hideous mutilations, the reliefs and ration parties never arriving, the senseless counterattacks to recapture, at impossible cost, a few yards of shell holes, the thirst, the hunger, the stench, the misery, the fear. Above all, always the shells. A young lieutenant killed at Verdun scrawled in his journal, "They will not be able to make us do it again another day. That would be to misconstrue the price of our effort. They will have to resort to those who have not lived these days." Privately, the men of France's post-war army wondered to themselves if they could do Verdun again, if any other Frenchman, if any other human being could. In the lassitude left by the war, they felt the answer morally was no. There was indeed no doubt that, numerically, Verdun was the kind of battle that France, with her depleted population, could never, never fight again. But what kind of battle could she fight? Certainly, whatever those British critics of Churchill might have feared, it seemed increasingly improbable that France could ever herself engage in offensive warfare. Defensively, her interests were protected by the Versailles Treaty, for the time being. But the function of military staffs is to plan for contingency. France might, nevertheless, be attacked once again by the traditional enemy. In this event, how could she fight a defensive battle without suffering a Verdun? What new strategy, what new technique could be evolved to avoid it? In their pursuit of an alternative, the footsteps of France's military thinkers led them back towards Verdun itself. The actual lessons gained there, and the conclusions drawn from them, constitute the third and most portentous influence emanating from that hideous battlefield. Most of the siege warfare of 1914 to 1918 had surged back and forth over an amorphous line of trenches. What was peculiar about Verdun was the presence of concentric clusters of powerful underground forts, although, for various reasons, France had grossly neglected these at the beginning of the battle, its subsequent course seemed to indicate that Verdun owed its survival to them. The mightiest of these forts, Douaumont, had actually been captured early on in an extraordinary, bloodless coup by a small group of Germans. Its loss was later estimated to have cost the French the equivalent of 100,000 men. Its neighbour, Fort Vaux, with a garrison of only 250 men, heroically stood up to a whole German army corps and delayed the advance on Verdun one vital week. Others, like Souville, proved invaluable by furnishing shell-proof shelters from which infantry could sally forth to repulse the attacking Germans, while supporting them with fire from artillery mounted beneath almost indestructible carapaces of thick steel. Only the very heaviest enemy shells could penetrate them. When a French army commission, led by Marshal Joffre, visited Verdun in 1922, it was astonished at the way in which the forts had absorbed the pounding of the German Big Berthas, an impression reinforced by the nigh impenetrable strength which their scrutiny of Germany's deep-dug Hindenburg line revealed. If only the French High Command could have utilized those forts properly in 1916, think how many valuable Poilu lives might have been saved, all the while assuring the integrity of Verdun. Let these lessons not be ignored, the Commission warned itself. The Maginot Line. There was an additional factor. From the days of the barbarians onwards, France had constantly lain open to invasion through her vulnerable eastern frontier. With the new rapidity of movement afforded by railways, it had twice been proved, in 1870 as in 1914, that a battle lost in the east could bring the Germans to the very doors of Paris itself within a matter of weeks. In Lorraine and the Nord, France's most vital industrial centres lay particularly exposed to German aggression, and deprivation of these had so nearly brought defeat in the Great War. Among a nation where the peasant voice still predominated, the soil of France, every square yard of it, assumed sacred qualities. It was the unyielding defence of this which had persuaded the French High Command to adopt such rigid and costly tactics at Verdun. After the stabilisation of the fronts in 1914, the French infantry had paid out a steady and prodigious rent in blood just to hold on to that continuous line of ill-protected trenches stretching from Switzerland to the North Sea. But at least they had held, and by doing so had ensured the inviolability of France's sacred soil. Supposing now, the Army Commission of 1922 asked itself, France should prepare to defend herself behind not shallow, hastily dug trenches, but a continuous and permanent line of forts, even deeper and more sophisticated than those of Verdun. In the event of another German war, would not such a line surely save both lives and the ravaging of French territory? Might not its mere existence pose a formidable deterrent to any aggressive-minded German ruler in the future? For 7 years, the Battle of Verdun was refought in the higher councils of French military thought, as argument swayed back and forth over the blueprints for France's new fortress line. On one premise, the majority were agreed from the start. The line must represent a continuous front. Above all this was the view of Pétain, appointed Inspector General of the Army after the war, and, as age removed Joffre and Foch from the scene, for many successive years her most influential soldier. He was also the man who had been more closely concerned in the immortal defence of Verdun than any other. But although Pétain, in the years following his trial and disgrace, has come to be regarded in France as a scapegoat for all that was faulty about interwar military thinking, it is entirely unjust to suggest that he single-handedly laced his army into a kind of intellectual straitjacket. The French army donned it all too willingly. For during the past war, its officer corps had had no contact with the great fluid movements of the campaign in the east, in which so many Germans had taken part, nor had they even any direct knowledge of the highly mobile campaigns fought by Allenby and the British in Palestine. "We had been haunted," wrote a distinguished subsequent army leader, General Boffre, "by the tenacity of the German machine guns and the impossibility in which we found ourselves of breaking the enemy front." Note, André Boffre, a junior staff officer at the Ministry of War after the First World War, later became a full general and one of France's leading military intellects after the Second World War. He led the French contingent at Suez in 1956. From the lessons of their 4 years of static warfare, which even the introduction of tanks did disappointingly little to alter, had emerged the doctrine of the continuous front, to be espoused by the great mass of French military thought, with its experience of no other form of strategy. This, thought the École Militaire all through the 1920s, must prove to be the shape of future warfare. Moreover, it was a shape peculiarly expedient for the defence of the soil of France. But expediency usually turns out to be a poor strategic guide. On the 4th of January 1930, a vast majority in both chambers of the National Assembly voted for a law accepting the Army's long-debated plans for a great wall on the eastern frontier. André Maginot, who had become one of the Third Republic's most honourable politicians, happened to be Minister of War at the time. Thus, it was his name that the fortress line would bear henceforth. For the first phase of its construction, the Assembly voted the immense sum of 3,000 million francs, to be spread over 4 years. Note, £24 million at the then rate of exchange. Work on the Maginot Line began at once. As Maginot himself stressed, it had to be completed by 1935, the date appointed by the Versailles Treaty for France finally to withdraw her troops from the Rhineland. It was to run from Bâle, on the borders of Switzerland, to Longwy, close to where the Belgian, Luxembourg, and French frontiers meet. Why it was not intended to continue to Dunkirk, thus covering Belgium, will be seen later. The strength and depth of line varied, but for 87 miles it consisted of fortified regions, guarding two major invasion avenues. One covered a potential assault aimed at Metz and Nancy, while the other faced north to guard the plains of Lower Alsace. Facing directly east, a series of lesser fortifications backed up the wide river barrier of the Rhine. Just behind the frontier, the defences of the two fortified regions began with a series of anti-tank obstacles and barbed wire, backed up by reinforced barracks, known as maisons fortes, stronghouses, and pillboxes, the object of these advance posts being to provide warning of an attack and delay it. At their rear came a deep anti-tank ditch, and then the subterranean casemates and forts, which comprised the backbone of the line. Protected by up to 10 feet of concrete, each casemate contained rapid-firing anti-tank guns and machine guns, firing out of underground slits with a 50-degree arc, as well as grenade throwers to dislodge any enemy infantry approaching by means of dead ground. Their 25-man garrison lived and slept on a floor still deeper under the earth. Superbly blended into their environment, about all that an enemy could see of these concrete casemates were two small nipples formed by the observation cupolas surmounting them. The real pride of the Maginot Line, however, lay in its forts, which backed up the casemates at an interval of every 3 to 5 miles. Ever since Vauban, French engineers have been without rivals in the art of fortification, and the Verdun forts had been masterpieces of their time. But these new concrete and steel monsters were veritable wonders of the modern world. When troops passed through their cavernous gates, placed discreetly at the base of some hill, they entered into a Wellesian civilization in which they could live, sleep, eat, work, and exercise for many weeks without ever seeing the surface of the earth, not unlike nuclear submariners of today embarking on a voyage under the pole. Electric trains whisked them from their underground barracks and canteens to their gun turrets. Vast power stations, equally underground, provided them with heat and light. Powerful compressor plants supplied them with air and ensured that the forts were proof against poison gas. Immense subterranean food stores, reservoirs, and fuel tanks would enable them to remain cut off from the rest of the French army for up to 3 months. There were three different types of forts, the biggest of which, Category 1, housed a garrison of up to 1,200 officers and men, and contained between 15 and 18 concrete blocks, each bristling with guns mounted in disappearing turrets and of calibers that ranged from 37mm to 135mm. Each fort was divided in two, connected by deep subterranean galleries lying beyond the penetration of any bomb or shell, and varying between 400 yards and 1.5 miles in length. Thus, even if one half of the fort should be knocked out, the other half could continue to fight, and each half was so located that it could bring down supporting fire on its twin, its neighbouring forts, or casemates. At Verdun, the greatest danger experienced by the French forts had been from infantry infiltrating onto their superstructures and working their way underground. Both Douaumont and Vaux had been lost in this way. To prevent a repetition, the Maginot Line plan incorporated interval troops, infantry complete with field artillery, which could be moved up to counter any threat to a particular fort or group of forts. These were intended to compensate for what, by definition, the line lacked: mobility. Note, though ironically enough, when the supreme test came, the drain imposed by maintaining the interval troops was to be one of the leading factors in depriving the French army of the mobility it so sadly lacked. Much has been said about why the Maginot Line failed to save France in 1940, though not always have the right reasons been given. It was enormously costly, partly owing to errors of construction due to bureaucratic jealousies. The 87 miles of fortified regions, completed by 1935, had already cost 7,000 million francs, far in excess of the parliamentary estimates. In addition to its construction, the maintenance of the Maginot Line represented a considerable financial burden. For a country plagued by chronic budgetary difficulties and with a powerful left wing opposed to rearmament in any form, this overall costliness meant that, inevitably, the French army would be forced to accept economies elsewhere. The Maginot Line also lacked depth, with its four successive positions never occupying, even in their most advanced state, a belt larger than 12 miles deep. This, too, was a consequence of expense. But the most mortal defect of the line lay not in its depth, but its length. Romantically, it came to be dubbed the Shield of France. The essence of a shield, however, is that it can be manipulated to protect any portion of its owner's body. The Maginot Line obviously was incapable of motion, yet it did not extend to cover what Clausewitz called the pit of the French stomach, the classical invasion route across the Belgian plains, over which the Schlieffen plan had so nearly brought total calamity in 1914. By as late as 1935, the motives for not fortifying the remaining 250 miles along the Belgian frontier were only partially related to problems of cost. This extension would have to run right through the heavily industrialized Lille-Valenciennes area, which straddles the frontier, and would be immeasurably disruptive as well as costly. A factor carrying even greater weight, however, was that Belgium, mindful of how her neutrality had been outraged by Germany in 1914, remained France's close ally, so that a fortified line on the French side of her frontier would leave her out in the cold, abandoned on the wrong side of the ramparts. She would then have no option but to return to her former neutrality and rely upon German morals. Pétain, despite his reputation for defensive-mindedness, made it quite clear, when Minister of War in 1934, that in the event of any German aggression, it was part and parcel of French strategy to go into Belgium and to fight an offensive war of movement against the enemy there. Note: both in 1927 and 1932, Pétain, the president of the Army Council, had stressed the importance of having a mobile force near the frontier, and to make sure of its swift advances into Belgium. As the French army stood in 1934, still with its crushing superiority over the Germans, who had not yet invented the Panzer Corps, this strategy made excellent sense, as long as Belgium remained within the alliance. It was also clearly in France's interest, though she could hardly explain this to the Belgians, to protect her soil by fighting the battle, with all its destructiveness, as far forward of her frontiers as possible. With the construction of the Maginot Line, the wheel of French military thought, which had started spinning in 1870, performed a fatal full cycle. In 1870, to state it in the simplest terms, France had lost a war through adopting too defensive a posture and relying too much on permanent fortifications. Fortress cities such as Strasbourg, Metz, and Paris herself had been simply enveloped by Moltke's Prussians and besieged one by one. In reaction against this calamitous defeat, France had nearly lost the next war by being too aggressive-minded. Now she was once again seeking safety under concrete and steel. Rapidly, the Maginot Line came to be not just a component of strategy, but a way of life. Feeling secure behind it, like the lotus-eating mandarins of Cathay behind their great wall, the French army allowed itself to atrophy, to lapse into desuetude. A massive combination of factors: complacency, lassitude, deficiency of manpower and finance conspired to rust the superb weapon which the world had so admired on that 14 juillet of 1919. The French army, men and arms. By the end of 1935, the eve of France's first major confrontation with Hitler, her army was below par both in numbers and quality of manpower. The call-up was just beginning to suffer the full effect of the hollow classes caused by the drop in births during the Great War. In Germany, for instance, the 1915 class available for conscription, if it were not for the restrictions imposed by Versailles, amounted to 464,000 men. In France, it was only 184,000, a ratio that would continue right the way through to the Second World War. Yet politics had forced a reduction in the length of military service from 3 years to 1, and hopes that the population deficit of metropolitan France could be made good by a vast colonial army were never quite fulfilled. Thus, instead of a total strength of over 300,000 men, about two-thirds of this was the most the French could muster. As far as the hard core of professionals was concerned, there was certainly little enough inducement for good men to stay on. With a captain paid approximately £11 a month, and a major in command of a whole battalion paid only £16, officers without private incomes lived in desperate straits. Note, even in the underpaid British Army at this time, a captain, unmarried, received a basic pay of £38 a month, a major £53. They had no vote, and now that the supreme goal, revenge, had been achieved, wherein resided the glory of an army career. Composed of all too many officers whom the previous war had left drained of élan vital, the French general staff allowed itself to become bogged down in bureaucratic methods. Paperasserie, as the French call it, the blight to which all armies are susceptible, flourished. It was difficult to see exactly where the power of decision lay. The once omnipotent and cohesive Conseil supérieur de la guerre, Supreme War Council, from whose members would be designated France's senior commanders in time of war, no longer filled anything but a consultative role. Divided by mutual antipathy and jealousies, its generals had little contact with each other. Their staffs followed suit, each existing in its own watertight compartment. There was not much discussion on a higher strategic and tactical plane, and what there was tended to follow abstract intellectual paths from which little practical use ever emerged. General Bouffre, writing of his own experiences at that time, states that at the Ministry of War, the general commanded in theory, but had not the money, the administration, the personnel, or the equipment. The permanent secretary had the money and the administration without the responsibility of command. The various departments had personnel and equipment, but neither money nor command. The minister stood at the head of all this, but could achieve nothing without obtaining unison from the whole orchestra, the complexity of which helped to paralyze all initiatives. The ensemble possessed only one force, that of inertia. In this state of inertia, the army tended to rest content with the techniques and equipment of 1918. To a large extent, the financial strain imposed on successive military budgets by the Maginot Line provided it with little alternative. Note, arms credits for 1936 totaled 1,492 million francs, roughly a fifth of what had already been spent on the Maginot Line. Although, with the taxis of the Marne and later by her victualling of Verdun along the Voie Sacrée, the Sacred Road, the French army had pioneered warfare by road, as its post-war mechanical transport aged and was not replaced, it regressed to relying for mobility once more on railways and horses, while other armies, notably the German, were experimenting with radio communications, the French clung to the telephone, even despite the lessons gained from 1914 to 1918, when operations had so often failed after the severing of lines by artillery barrages, and regardless of the new threat to land communications which modern air power and tanks posed. In 1924, the army decided to replace its automatic rifle and to modify the standard infantry cartridge. The new weapon came into service by 1932, but, typical of the prevailing inertia, the rifle, intended to utilize the same cartridge, was not selected until 1936. As late as 1939, only a few hundred thousand had been issued. General Weygand, before he retired as Inspector General of the Army in 1933, had prescribed that 5 infantry divisions be motorized and a cavalry division be converted into a division légère mécanique. But otherwise, the rest of the army showed little advance on that which had processed so resplendently through Paris in 1919. Note, light mechanized division, which was something of a misnomer in that the DLMs were largely equipped with the excellent Saumur medium tank, more heavily armored than most of its German counterparts. They also had a strength of 220 tanks each, compared with only 150 for each of the subsequently created French armoured divisions. Tanks and doctrine. There is no weightier problem, common to the general staffs of all peaceably minded countries in modern times, than the decision for what year to plan the re-equipment of its forces with a new armory. Note: in Britain, for instance, up to 1932, the services worked on the simple assumption each year of not having to anticipate a major war for at least another 10. Weapons designed too long before the moment of crisis, becoming speedily obsolete, are almost as useless as those that arrive too late. In its tank production policy, the French army had remained for many years a prisoner of the mass of machines left over from 1918. With the rise of Hitler, it adopted the expedient of building prototypes, while year by year postponing their mass production until such time as the threat of war seemed imminent, a notional date which self-deception and appeasement would constantly defer. So long as Germany obeyed Versailles, binding her not to build tanks, France's obsolete armor was quite sufficient for her purposes. In any case, she could hardly afford to replace it. But the most insidious long-term consequences, and it would be hard to find any single military factor contributing more directly to the defeat of 1940 of this residuum, lay in the shadow it cast over the development of France's doctrines of armored warfare. The bulk of the tanks inherited from the war consisted of the Renault FT model, lightly armored, slow, and strictly limited in operational radius. It was useless against concrete fortifications or in battle against other tanks. It was predominantly an instrument of infantry support. In the culminating battles of 1918, the FTs moved up with the infantry after the usual heavy bombardment. When the infantry had advanced beyond the range of their artillery and the tanks had run out of petrol, the attackers would consolidate and wait for the guns, drawn by horses, to move up and prepare for the next laborious step forward. At each pause, the hard-pressed Germans were given a respite in which to repair their defenses. Never was the rhythm of attack maintained. Never were the French tanks, numbering over 4,000, but spread out all along the front, concentrated for a breakthrough, and never did any deep penetration occur. Again and again, in the French communiques, there appeared sentences like the following: "The tanks put to flight the defenders, but the infantry did not reach the objective." Against an enemy that was already beaten, losses in both tanks and infantry were disheartening, the conclusions drawn discouraging. In his post-war instruction of 1921, Marshal Pétain, then supreme commander, dismissed the future role of armor in two lines: "Tanks assist the advance of the infantry by breaking static obstacles and active resistance put up by the enemy." For the next 14 years, this was to remain the accepted creed of the French army. As at Verdun, the plodding infantrymen dominated. But meanwhile, in England, a prophet had arisen with a new and revolutionary concept of warfare. A 24-year-old ex-regular officer, invalided out of the army as a result of gassing on the Somme, Captain Basil Littlehart, was invited to help draft the British Army's post-war infantry training manual. The manual gave him a first opportunity to propound his expanding torrent theory of deep, swift penetration as an antidote to the static warfare of 1914 to 1918. As his thoughts evolved, Littlehart saw offensive operations being spearheaded by powerful concentrations of fast-moving, wide-ranging tanks, no longer mere adjuncts of foot soldiery, and backed by equally mobile, self-propelled guns and infantrymen transported in armored carriers. Instead of battering away along a wide sector with the old methodical siege techniques, the attacker, having probed out a weak spot in the enemy's defenses, would pour through it at top speed with his expanding torrent of mobile firepower, creating vulnerable new fronts deep in the defender's rear. If Littlehart's theories and those of his contemporary, Major General J.F.C. Boney Fuller, should be proved viable, it obviously meant the death of the continuous front school of thought on which the whole of France's interwar strategy was based. Harried by this awkward and gangling guru and his small band of supporters within the walls, the British Army decided, in 1926, to lead the way by establishing an experimental mechanized force. Within 2 years, however, the conservative factions of the army establishment reasserted themselves, and this force was disbanded. In France, there was an even smaller body of bright young officers who, in Beaufres' words, found Littlehart's doctrine as dazzling a discovery as the rediscovery of antiquity must have seemed to the men of the Renaissance after the conformist sterilities of medieval scholasticism. But otherwise, comforted by the unreceptiveness of orthodoxy in England, the shapers of French military policy were able to ignore his teachings. Only elsewhere, in Germany, was their full import immediately grasped. In an attack upon proposals for the creation of an armored corps, Pétain's successor as Minister of War, General Morin, summed up French attitudes prevailing in 1935 when he asked the Chamber of Deputies, amid loud applause, "How can we still believe in the offensive when we have spent thousands of millions to establish a fortified barrier? Would we be mad enough to advance beyond this barrier upon goodness knows what adventure?" Yet if the offensive was damned and its mechanical requisites neglected, how then was the French army to carry out that essential component of Maginot Line strategy, the march into Belgium, against a presumptively rearmed and re-equipped Germany? Alliances undermined. The significance of the defensive posture the French army had adopted by the end of 1935 far exceeded simple military considerations of protecting France's own soil. Most important, it gravely impinged upon the system of alliances painfully constructed since 1919 as breakwaters against possible German aggression. From the very beginning, the Quai d'Orsay had realized that they could no longer count on the traditional ally of 1914, Russia, to contain Germany by means of the deterrent which the threat of a war on two fronts imposed. The Allies' policy of intervention, their subsequent instinctive mistrust of Bolshevism, and Russia's own multitudinous internal problems all made this quite clear. By way of a substitute, France had had to rely on diplomatic accords with the small nations of Eastern Europe, which had been carved out of the rump of Austria-Hungary, Germany, and Russia herself. On paper, the combined sum of their military forces seemed impressive enough, and the Poles, advised by General Wegon, had, for instance, proved themselves doughty warriors against the Red Army. But, as the aftermath of Munich was to prove, they would never be combined, insofar as they would just as soon cut each other's throats as form a coherent front against Hitler's Germany. In 1914, as the German surge through Belgium to the Marne, it was Russia who came to France's aid by taking the offensive. Now, it should have been obvious to any amateur strategist, France was faced with a reversal of the situation, and in the event of war, she would, in all probability, have to rush to the aid of her weaker eastern allies. Yet with that all-too-typical Gallic arrogance, all she asked was, "How can they help us?" and never, "How can we help them?" And France's defensive posture of the 1930s made it increasingly doubtful whether she could effectively help her allies at all. Ironically, the creation of Poland was to benefit Germany more than the Allies. Instead of providing a cordon sanitaire to protect Russia from the Germans, it meant that when the crucial moment came, in 1939, Russia would be unable, even if she had wanted, to help France, because a mistrustful Poland lay in the way. For France, the only hope of helping her eastern allies, threatened by Hitler's Germany, was for her to replay 1923, and how unpopular that had been, by marching into the Rhineland, the one part of Germany directly vulnerable to her. Yet, as General Morin had revealed with painful clarity, the Maginot Line strategy virtually discounted this possibility. So, as with Poland in the east, in the west, the Maginot Line indirectly came to be a cordon sanitaire protecting Germany, as well as France. Herein lay a fatal contradiction between France's diplomatic and military policies. And exploiting this contradiction, Hitler was soon to slam the door to the Rhineland in France's face by one swift, brutal act. Reoccupation of the Rhineland. On the 5th of March 1936, William Shirer, the CBS correspondent in Berlin, noted down in his diary, "Very ugly atmosphere in the Wilhelmstrasse today, but difficult to get to the bottom of it." 2 days later, the mystery solved itself, and Shirer could add, melodramatically, "Tonight, for the first time since 1870, grey-clad German soldiers and blue-clad French troops face each other across the Upper Rhine." Acting with the lightning speed, which was to characterize all his subsequent actions, Hitler had moved into the demilitarized Rhineland. Although rearmament had already been overtly underway for the past year, The new Wehrmacht was still a feeble infant which could only afford 3 battalions with which to make the initial crossing of the Rhine, and these had orders to withdraw immediately in the event of any French reaction. As yet, unarmed planes of the Luftwaffe flew from airfield to airfield to create an impression, and so, some German sources allege, as soon as they landed, new identity marks were painted on them. 3 battalions and a handful of planes cocking a snook at what was still rated as the world's most powerful land force. It was one of the most remarkable gambles in history. Would it come off? Extreme nervousness gripped the German army. During the crisis, Schaerer met General von Blomberg, the Minister of War, walking along with 2 dogs on the leash. His face was white, his cheeks twitching. Has something gone wrong? I wondered. Later, even Hitler admitted that the 48 hours after the march into the Rhineland were the most nerve-wracking in my life. All the world looked at France to see how she would meet this gross breach of the Versailles Treaty. In her turn, France looked towards Britain, but Britain was preoccupied with Italy and Abyssinia. Besides, had not France declared impatiently, just 2 years previously, thereby killing the disarmament conference, that France will henceforth guarantee her security by her own means? Note. For sheer arrogant folly, the Bartou Declaration of the 17th of April 1934 is hard to beat. A.J.P. Taylor remarks, the French had fired the starting pistol for the arms race. Characteristically, they then failed to run it. Yet it has its parallel in more recent times, when, in 1966, de Gaulle informed the North Atlantic Alliance that henceforth he felt strong enough to dispense with its benefits. There are moments when one feels that, like the Bourbons, only worse, France has learned nothing and forgotten everything. In any case, a large portion of Englishmen thoroughly agreed with Lord Lothian's historic comment about the Germans only going into their own back garden. So Britain told France that this was her problem. The French government called in General Gamelin, Wagon's successor as army commander-in-chief. Gamelin, already revealing himself a master of political, if not military, manoeuvre, temporised and equivocated in the style that was to prove so fatal to France 4 years later. Of course, his army was ready for instant action. But did the government realise that the Germans had nearly 1 million men under arms, 300,000 of them already in the Rhineland? It was an absurd exaggeration, deliberately intended to avoid action and pass the responsibility on to the politicians. Without conceding that the army might in any way be unfit for a swift defensive operation, Gamelin pointed out that it was numerically under strength, owing to the reduction in military service. Of course, the fault of the politicians, he implied. Then he dropped the bombshell that if it were to act over the Rhineland, the government would have to face up to the prospect of general mobilization. Note, in retrospect, Gamelin's torpor becomes all the more criminal when it appears that, as long as 2 months in advance of the reoccupation of the Rhineland, he had predicted to a French general, Armengaud, the likelihood of Hitler's move. Flandin, too, is purported to have raised the possibility in a cabinet meeting of January 1935. Why then did the French army allow itself to be taken by surprise? The French ministers looked at each other in horror. Mobilization? And 6 weeks before an election? It was madness. The electorate would never stand for it. Parliamentary defeat would be certain. Why, their very jobs were at stake. It was impossible. Now both the military and the politicians had their excuses. It remained to blame Britain for their joint paralysis of will. This was, however, said Churchill, an explanation, but no excuse. And indeed, at least in the opinion of Paul Reynaud, had France acted alone in defence of her vital interests, Britain would have been bound to back her up. Belgium opts out. So France did nothing, and Hitler got away with his first and most desperate gamble. The consequences were not long delayed. The most immediate followed with the reaction of France's ally, Belgium. That gallant sovereign who signed the Franco-Belgian alliance of 1920, King Albert, had died tragically in 1934. And his son, Leopold III, did not inherit the full measure of his wisdom and moral courage. Instead of the protective belt of the demilitarized Rhineland, the new king now saw armed German soldiers once again on Belgium's frontier, while behind him he saw an apparently impotent France. Wherein lay the security of Belgium? On the 14th of October 1936, Leopold III revoked the Franco-Belgian Treaty, thereby opting for a return to the neutral status of pre-1914. Said the king, with the optimism of the imprudent little pigs, "This policy should aim resolutely at keeping us apart from the quarrels of our neighbours." For France, it meant that, in the event of war, she could not enter Belgium until Hitler had already invaded. In one stroke, the whole of her Maginot Line strategy lay in fragments. Belgium's neutrality now confronted France with two fearful alternatives. No longer could there be any rush into Belgium, carefully coordinated with the army of an ally. Instead, either she would have to meet the invading Germans somewhere on the defenseless Flemish plains in a hastily improvised battle of encounter, such as her defensive-minded army was least suited for, or prepare to meet them once again on French soil, the prospect dreaded above all others. The only way to certain safety now lay in prolonging the Maginot Line to the sea. But the 87 existing miles of fortified regions had already cost 7,000 million francs, and it was obvious that to extend the line all the way to the sea, through the industrialized north, would prove infinitely more expensive. So the politicians of the Third Republic resorted to that time-honored expedient of deceiving their constituents and their allies by pretending to do something which they recognized to be beyond their powers. Meanwhile, in the reoccupied Rhineland itself, Hitler hastened the construction of his own powerful line of concrete forts, opposing the Maginot Line, the West Wall or Siegfried Line. As Churchill predicted in a remarkable prophecy on the 6th of April 1936, those fortifications would enable the German troops to be economized on that line and will enable the main forces to swing round through Belgium and Holland. Then look east. There the consequences of the Rhineland fortification may be more immediate. Poland and Czechoslovakia, with which must be associated Yugoslavia, Romania, Austria, and some other countries, are all affected very decisively the moment that this great work of construction has been completed. Indeed, its completion would make it virtually impossible for France to render any effective aid to her eastern allies. Hitler could henceforth mop up in the east at will, then, with his rear secured, deal with an isolated France when the moment came. The reoccupation of the Rhineland marked the watershed between 1919 and 1939. No other single event in this period was more loaded with dire significance. From March 1936, the road to France's doom ran downhill all the way. In Germany, Hitler was rearming with terrifying speed. Chapter 3. Fortune changes sides. Before the year was out, it seemed as if Fortune, recognizing her masters, was changing sides. Winston S. Churchill, A History of the English-Speaking Peoples, Volume 3, On the Coming of Pitt. There are only two powers in the world, the sword and the spirit. In the long run, the sword is always defeated by the spirit. Napoleon. Sunday, the 17th of March 1935, was Heroes' Remembrance Day in Germany. At a ceremony in Berlin State Opera House, Hitler presided, flanked on the right by the veteran August von Mackensen, Germany's last surviving field marshal, and on the left by Crown Prince Wilhelm, the heir to the deposed Kaiser and one-time commander of the army attacking Verdun. The whole of the stalls was a sea of military uniforms. To William Shirer, it was a scene which Germany had not seen since 1914. Far from being one of sober commemoration of the Great War dead, the atmosphere was charged with jubilation and thanksgiving. Amid powerful acclaim, Blomberg declared, "The world has been made to realize that Germany did not die of its defeat." It was a fact, for the previous day, Hitler, in full defiance of Versailles, had announced to the world his intention to rearm, and to do so by introducing conscription. Hitler rearms. The sequence of events which led to the nightmarish rise of the Third Reich lies still too close to us for anything new to be added here, even if it belonged to this story. But having sketched in the decline of the French army up to the Rhineland crisis of 1936, one needs to examine briefly the awe-inspiring process by which Hitler, within the following 4 years, was to create a force not only crushingly superior to the combined might of France and Britain, but indeed the most dazzling instrument of war the world had yet seen. By the end of his first year in power, Hitler had already secretly ordered the army to treble its statutory strength of 100,000 men, imposed by Versailles, before October 1934. During that year, the defense budget was drastically raised from 172 million Reichsmarks to 654 million. Then, on the 10th of March 1935, Hitler deliberately leaked to the British press, as a ballon d'essai, the news that he already possessed an air force in the shape of the infant Luftwaffe. His pretext was that France had just expanded her own army by retaining a class of conscripts, which had been done, in fact, simply to mitigate the consequences of the hollow classes. No more than a blast of protest was registered by either France or Britain, so, on the 16th of March, Hitler went ahead and published his brief decree announcing the creation of a new German army, based on compulsory military service. In peacetime alone, the number of its divisions would comprise the imposing total of 36. This was many more than was wanted by even the grateful generals congregated in the state opera the next day. They realized the mountainous difficulties that digesting this huge expansion would present to the small regular cadres. In fact, as has already been seen, by the time of the reoccupation of the Rhineland, the new Wehrmacht was still a relatively feeble, small, and lightly armed force. As yet, no more than 5% of Germany's national product was being spent on rearmament. But then, as later, what Hitler lacked in actual hardware, he made up for by the loudness and terrorizing effect of his boasting. After 1936, there followed the quiet 2 years of semi-respectability, the years of no territorial adventures, during which the expanding Wehrmacht assumed its definitive shape. By the beginning of 1937, its army divisions numbered 39. By 1939, 51. Note, upon mobilization in August 1939, this number was doubled. By 1939, it had also added to its potential the manpower of both Austria and the Sudeten Germans. Seyckt's bequest. When Hitler began the task of rearming Germany, daunting though it was, he was presented with a number of advantages denied to the French. First, as the vanquished party, the German army was not saddled with the victor's impedimenta of obsolescent ideas and equipment. Secondly, Hitler inherited some remarkably solid groundwork in the shape of Colonel General Hans von Seyckt's Reichswehr. As Mackensen's chief of staff on the Russian front, Seyckt had been responsible for the spectacular breakthrough at Gorlice in 1915. His monocle and hard features, making him seem like a traditional rigid Prussian Junker, in fact concealed the remarkable elasticity and breadth of vision. From the moment of taking over command of the Reichswehr, on the morrow of defeat, his guiding principle had been to neutralize the poison in the clauses of the Versailles Treaty by which the German army had been disarmed, and to create a nucleus from which a new and greater army could one day be formed. When the Allied terms had forced the Reichswehr to purge some 20,000 of its officers, Seyckt made sure that it was the elite who remained. Every subaltern was trained to command a battalion and every field officer a division. At one moment, out of the 100,000 men permitted by Versailles, 40,000 were NCOs, and each of these was regarded as potential officer material. Mistrustful of the unwieldy mass armies of conscripts of 1914 to 1918, so lacking in mobility, Seyckt selected the rank and file of the Reichswehr, all from carefully vetted volunteers. Determined to safeguard traditional values, at the same time, he introduced a new, closer, and more comradely relationship between officers and men, based on mutual confidence. Gone was the stiff social segregation, which to a large extent still afflicted the French army. And gone, too, was much of the harsh bullying, or commis, of the old days. The result was a remarkably professional, technically efficient force in miniature. Considerable ingenuity was employed to surmount the Allied restrictions imposed on heavy equipment. In Reichswehr maneuvers, right up to 1932, soldiers could be seen trundling along dummy tanks mounted on bicycle wheels. After protracted arguments with the Allies, the Germans were permitted to construct a small armored vehicle with a revolving turret. Although barred from carrying any weapon, it was of great use in teaching officers the art of armored warfare. Barred from producing any tracked vehicles, the Germans ingeniously developed 8- and 10-wheeled armored cars, forerunners of the famous eight-wheeled reconnaissance vehicle which did such good service during the Second World War. Note, within a year of the departure of the Allied Control Commission in 1927, Krupp was producing the first tanks, and under the strange, secret alliance with the Soviet Union, these were shipped in pieces to Kazan on the Volga to be put through their paces there. Short of transport, Sicht began experimenting with motorcycle companies, later an essential component of the Wehrmacht's blitzkrieg technique. But Sicht's greatest contribution lay in guiding German military thoughts onto the correct lines. He insisted, wrote Churchill, that false doctrines, springing from personal experiences of the Great War, should be avoided. All the lessons of that war were thoroughly and systematically studied. New principles of training and instructional courses of all kinds were introduced. All the existing manuals were rewritten. Unlike the French, with their vision fixed upon the static warfare of the Western Front, too gratified by the fact of final victory to study the military mistakes which had come so close to compromising it, Sicht, together with many other German staff officers who had fought on the Russian front, enjoyed the advantage of having seen that there were other ways of waging war. He himself had helped devise the tactics of the great sweeping operations in the East and had directed the breakthrough at Gorica, leading to a depth of penetration such as was never to occur in the West. From these wartime experiences, he concluded, as early as 1921, "The whole future of warfare appears to me to be in the employment of mobile armies, relatively small but of high quality, and rendered distinctly more effective by the addition of aircraft." Guderian and the Panzer Corps. Sicht retired for political reasons in 1926 and died 10 years later, but he left solid foundations for his successors to build upon. In 1922, a 34-year-old staff captain called Heinz Guderian was appointed to the staff of the Army's motor transport. A signals specialist, it was the first time he had had anything to do with mechanization. During the Great War, Guderian, as an intelligence officer at the Crown Prince's HQ, had been at Verdun throughout the German offensive of 1916. What he had seen there had been enough to convince him that the senseless carnage of this kind of static warfare should never again be indulged in. Encouraged by the ideas of Sicht, he began ardently to study the effect of motorization on mobility, and at an early stage fell under the profound influence of the writings of the British military thinkers, Little Hart, Fuller, and Martel. After 18 months in the Inspectorate of Transport, Guderian was selected to assist Lieutenant Colonel von Brauchitsch at exercises in cooperation between motorized troops and aircraft. Note, later Field Marshal and Hitler's Army Commander-in-Chief in 1940. He did so well that he was next given a job lecturing on tactics and military history, which provided him with an admirable opportunity to develop his ideas further. By 1929, Guderian himself claims that he had become convinced of the fundamental importance of integrated armored divisions, in which tanks would assume the primary role instead of being subordinate to the infantry. In 1931, he received his first motorized command of a battalion equipped with dummy tanks and dummy anti-tank guns. Meanwhile, in Britain, during 1934, some advanced experiments on deep penetration had been carried out by General Hobart's 1st Tank Brigade. Guderian kept abreast of these maneuvers by employing, at his own expense, a local tutor to translate Little Hart's articles about them the moment they were printed in England. By the following year, his own thinking had reached the point where he could both give utterance to it in an astoundingly prophetic book and put it into practice. As has often been the humiliating story with British inventions and discoveries, the development of armour was now left to another, unfriendly country. Guderian began his book, Achtung, Panzer, by examining the causes underlying the success and failure of Allied tank operations. The Germans missed the boat and hardly employed any tanks at all during the First War. He listed the following fundamental errors. The Allies did not attack in sufficient depth and were never backed up by sufficiently powerful mobile reserves, so that they broke into the enemy front but never through, where they would have been able to knock out his batteries, his reserves, his staffs, all at the same time. The full potential of the tanks was sacrificed by their being yoked to two such slow-moving components as foot infantry and horse-drawn artillery. They were thrown in by penny packets instead of powerful concentrations, and they were the wrong kind of tanks. Guderian saw the remedy to all this lying in the fully mechanized panzer divisions, all the components of which would collaborate closely together, and which had to be capable of moving at equal speeds. The panzer division was to be built around the tank itself, not the slow, short-range infantry escort tank, to which the French army was still wedded, but a medium breakthrough tank, possessing armor sufficient to protect it against the mass of enemy anti-tank weapons, a higher speed and greater cruising range than the infantry escort tank, and an armament of machine guns and cannon up to 75 millimeters. Note: it was significant that the Infant Panzer Corps chose to base its procedure on the British Army manual on the use of armor rather than on the French, because of the rigidity of the French links between tanks and infantry. From the beginning, these tanks' commanders would be trained to fight in large units, thus providing maximum concentration of firepower. Close behind the breakthrough tanks would follow motorized infantry, with the role of mopping up and exploiting the successes of the armor, and interspersed with them would be mobile anti-tank guns. These were to be rushed offensively forward to hold the vulnerable flanks of the panzer salient against any counterattack by enemy tanks. The unwieldy horse-drawn artillery of 1914 to 1918 would be replaced by self-propelled guns mounted on tracks. But here, Guderian, writing in 1936, was able to provide a solution which he admitted to be only partially satisfactory. The essence of the panzer thrust, he stressed, must be surprise. Yet a prolonged softening-up bombardment, even from highly mobile artillery, was always liable to give the game away, as happened repeatedly during the set-piece offensives of the Great War. The full answer was only to come with the development, later, of the Stuka dive bomber. Guderian stressed the advantage of tanks attacking in mass, and, if possible, at early dawn, on account of the difficult targets they would present to the defenders' anti-tank guns. He also stressed the need to strike with such speed that the tanks would get into the enemy's main defense zone before these guns could be properly sighted. But he regarded the most dangerous opponent of the panzer division to be the enemy tank. If the attacker cannot succeed in beating them, then the breakthrough can be considered as having failed, because neither the infantry nor the artillery will be able to get through any longer. Everything depends on delaying intervention of enemy anti-tank reserves and tanks, and encountering them as early as possible with powerful units, that is, panzer units, capable of taking part in a tank battle in the full depths of the battlefield, in the area of the enemy reserves and command centers. The intervention of the defenders' reserves was to be delayed by the tactical air force, which Guderian already saw as working in close cooperation with the panzers. This delaying task would be one of the air power's principal functions in the battle. He also mentions the employment of airborne troops in capturing important points in the enemy rear to open routes for the oncoming panzer thrust. Once the attacker had succeeded in breaking through into the enemy's defense area, the crushing of the enemy batteries and the mopping up of the infantry battle zone can be achieved with relatively weak panzer units. The infantry can then exploit the successes of the tanks. The endeavor to strike the enemy defense simultaneously in its whole depth, continues Guderian, must therefore be regarded as highly justified. This lofty goal is only to be achieved with numerous tanks in the necessary deep deployment, with panzer units and panzer leaders who have been taught to fight in large units and to break any unforeseen resistance rapidly and decisively. Apart from its depth, the breakthrough attack must also be on so great a width that the outflanking of a center of the attack is made difficult. With us, sum up our demands for a decision-seeking panzer attack in these terms: suitable terrain, surprise, and mass deployment in the necessary width and depth. Here lay an astonishingly accurate blueprint of how, 4 years later, Guderian himself would effect the breakthrough at Sedan. In Mein Kampf, Hitler had already broadcast to the world his intentions to obtain Lebensraum by conquest in Europe. Now, in detail, Guderian revealed the technique by which these conquests were to be made. Despite the admonition contained in its very title, Achtung Panzer was ignored by French and British leaders even more completely than Mein Kampf had been. It was never translated into either French or English, and appears never to have been properly studied by anyone in a key position in the general staffs of either country. Yet already, by February 1935, the Deuxième Bureau, so its chief, General Gaucher, tells us, had warned the French High Command of the potential of Germany's embryo panzer divisions. Moreover, by the time of the publication of Achtung Panzer, Guderian was already a well-known military figure who had published his theories in professional magazines for all to read and was now commanding Hitler's 2nd Panzer Division. As early as 1933, when Hitler had attended a demonstration of Germany's earliest tank prototype, he exclaimed repeatedly to Guderian, "That's what I need! That's what I want to have!" Hitler's own technical grasp was a constant source of astonishment to his advisers. Mechanical details fascinated him, and among other things, it was reputedly he who first suggested, in 1938, that the 88mm anti-aircraft gun be used in an anti-tank role, thereby giving birth to a weapon which was perhaps the most successful to be used on either side in the Second World War. But above all, Guderian and his theories were just what Hitler needed to execute his policy of lightning conquests effected with minimum force. With that visionary intuition of his, he had remarked to Hermann Rauschning, shortly after coming to power, "The next war will be quite different from the last World War. Infantry attacks and mass formations are obsolete. Interlocked frontal struggles lasting for years on petrified fronts will not return. I guarantee that." They were a degenerate form of war. And later, even more prophetically, "I shall maneuver France right out of her Maginot Line without losing a single soldier." Although Guderian had to face opposition from conservative elements in the German army, almost as tough as anything encountered by the French and British reformers, under Hitler's patronage he received the utmost support. In October 1935, the first three panzer divisions were formed, Guderian, still only a colonel, receiving command of one of them. By the beginning of 1938, Guderian was promoted lieutenant general and placed in command of the Mobile Corps, which played a leading role in the march into Austria. At the end of that year, now a full general, he received the key post of Chief of Mobile Troops on the General Staff. Guderian and the philosophy of Blitzkrieg had arrived. The Revolutionary Wehrmacht. In Achtung Panzer, Guderian describes the highest human quality called for by the Panzer Corps as being a fanatical will to move forward. It was this very quality which the strange and terrible creed of National Socialism was instilling into the new Wehrmacht as a whole. How difficult it is at this range to recapture, let alone explain, the instant magic that, in the 1930s, Hitler wielded over German youth, sublimely unaware as it was of the dark tunnel of unprecedented horror into which he would eventually lead them and all Europe. Onto the fertile stock of German childhoods, cast over by the miseries of hunger, crazy inflation, followed by depression and mass unemployment, the humiliations of defeat and occupation, the apparent injustices of Versailles, and the seeming pointlessness of life under Weimar, Hitler was able to graft the bud of intoxication. As Nietzsche said of the Germans, "Intoxication means more to them than nourishment. That is the hook they will always bite on. A popular leader must hold up before them the prospect of conquests and splendor. Then he will be believed." Hitler was believed, and his early bloodless conquests confirmed and reconfirmed that belief. Satisfying some elemental need for mysticism in the German soul, the gigantic Nuremberg rallies, with their pageantry and color, their hysterical, chanting masses of assenting humanity, filled young Germans with a kind of revolutionary fervor which they carried with them into the Wehrmacht. Among the older generation, for all those whose nightmare memories of the shell holes on the Western Front, implanted as deeply as in French minds, caused them to wonder fearfully where Hitler's rearmament would lead, there were many who could think only of one word: revenge. Visiting Germany in 1934, Jean-Paul Sartre was deeply shocked by the fanaticism of an ex-sergeant of the Great War. "If there's another war," he said, "we shall not be defeated this time. We shall retrieve our honor." Sartre replied that there was no need for a war. Everyone ought to want peace. "But honor comes first," the sergeant said. "First we must retrieve our honor." As Hitler's successes brought his promises to reverse the diktat of Versailles ever closer to fulfillment, so did the number of those sharing the views of Sartre's ex-sergeant multiply. Patriotism rekindled, the army became imbued with a new glory. a military career, satisfied the young German's inherent yearning for Kameradschaft, as well as his passion for mechanical matters, canalizing all that tremendous fund of technical skill and imagination latent in Germany in the 1920s and early 1930s. At the same time, the Wehrmacht's program of expansion promised swift promotion. Here, at last, was something that imparted to life a new meaning. Seeckt and Guderian had provided the Wehrmacht with a revolutionary doctrine, Hitler and Nazism, a revolutionary spirit to go with it. The training of German youth, both within the new Wehrmacht and earlier in various paramilitary organizations, was in itself revolutionary. Their regimented education began at a tender age. At 10, they entered the Jungvolk, pledging to devote all my energies and my strength to the savior of our country, Adolf Hitler. I am willing and ready to give up my life for him, so help me God. At 12, the most outstanding members of the Jungvolk were picked out to be dispatched to special schools for the instruction of elite cadres. The emphasis here, as everywhere else under the Nazis' educational system, was strongly on physical culture and disciplined teamwork. Among other preliminary military training, the boys also received courses in parachute jumping. At 14, young Germans became eligible to join the vast body of the Hitler Youth itself. In 1936, a law was passed closely coordinating the Hitler Youth with the Wehrmacht. From local units, its members received instruction in marksmanship and leadership, visited army barracks, and were taken to watch maneuvers. One of the liaison officers organizing these programs was a certain Lieutenant Colonel Erwin Rommel. At 18, youths became of age for conscription into the Wehrmacht, or the Arbeitsdienst, labor service. Inside the Arbeitsdienst, while young Germans served their country by building roads and barracks, the work of inseminating corporate consciousness and paramilitary discipline and of preaching the essential classlessness of the new order continued. Then, for vacation times, there was the Nazi Strength Through Joy welfare organization to provide still further regimented Kameradschaft. There was no mistaking the enthusiasm of the recipients of this massive indoctrination. Even a dispassionate British journalist, studying these young Germans of 1933, was deeply impressed, as indeed were so many other observers at the time, by the tremendous sense of comradeship amongst themselves. They were happy to learn together, play together, march together, and to learn to fight together. They loved the open air, and they flung away clothes from them with an abandon which would have horrified the Victorian generation. Their animal energy was gigantic. Note, Terence Pretty, Germans Against Hitler. By the time they reached the Wehrmacht, these Spartan, dedicated youths were already superlative material for a revolutionary force, instinctively versed in the one craft which was to pay off in Germany's early military operations more than any other. Teamwork. Anti-militarism in France. By comparison, what contrast one may glimpse in the spirit of France of the mid-1930s. The last of those rosy post-war illusions had been roughly swept aside by the revelation of her impotence during the Rhineland crisis. The urge for national grandeur, the desire for supremacy in Europe, were replaced by a deep longing, simply to be left in peace. It was a longing widely diffused through all strata of French society, though of course the symptoms were paralleled in and stimulated by the mood prevailing in the England of Cliveden and Lansbury, the peace ballot and the peace pledge union. But in France, particularly, the instinct for peace, or for what was later to become stigmatized as appeasement, remained strongly rooted in memories of the dreadfulness of the Great War, memories which, perhaps perversely, had become more rather than less potent with the passage of the years. This was to a large extent a consequence of the spate of anti-war literature which had swept Europe in the late 1920s, all telling basically the same tale of the horror and wastefulness of war, combined with the cynical callousness and sheer incompetence of the war leaders. In Germany, Hitler had been swift to stifle such books as Remarques, All Quiet on the Western Front. But in France, the terrifying novel of Henri Barbusse, Le Feu, had an immeasurable impact. For the Verdun generation, here indeed was an indelible reminder of what it had really been like. For their juniors, a nightmare fantasy, the reenactment of which must be avoided at all costs. Wielding enormous intellectual influence, were various anti-war associations, formed by such giants of France's literary left wing as André Gide, Paul Éluard, Louis Aragon, and Romain Rolland. But Barbusse was the torchbearer. When he died in 1935, more than 300,000 followed his coffin to Père Lachaise Cemetery. With his instinctive genius, Hitler knew well how to play on French fears and hopes, accompanying each new adventure with barrages of peace propaganda and repeated pledges of renunciation of any claim to Alsace-Lorraine, aimed at making Frenchmen sleep all the more comfortably at night behind the safety of their Maginot Line. With the vileness of the concentration camps yet to come, the full menace of the new order, only apparent when it would already be too late to check, Hitler did not seem especially malignant to the average Frenchman. Besides, as will be seen shortly, there were other dangers much closer to home. What hatred and fear of the Nazis there existed were roughly balanced out by equal hatred and fear of war itself. So often in history, when the unpleasantness of external reality induces a state of emotional confusion, societies become irresistibly tempted to bury themselves in all manner of imaginary pleasure and internal distractions. The louder the barbarians outside hammered at the walls of Rome, the wilder grew the public diversions in the Colosseum and the private orgies within the walls. At many levels of French life during the late 1920s and 1930s, escapism reveals itself as the ruling factor. Dadaism and surrealism in art are matched by the fantaisiste fairy tale world of Cocteau and Giraudoux. The frenzy of the foxtrot, danse aux manies of the 1920s, marches with the stage extravaganzas of Diaghilev, the ballet russe, the ballet suédois, Josephine Baker, the Revue Nègre, anything for spectacle. The circus is rediscovered. Then France suddenly finds she can play tennis and rugger. To be able to beat England provides a welcome sop to the Quai d'Orsay's growing dependence upon the Foreign Office. The sporting pages of Paris Soir make it overnight the journalistic success story of the decade. Bicycling is all the rage. For the masses, the Tour de France supplies the nearest emotional equivalent to Germany's Nuremberg rallies. In the cabarets, even the sacred fetishes of pre-1914 can be made mock of, with bearded ladies from Alsace chanting melodramatically, "No, no, 1,000 times no, my breast is French, I shall never give suck to a German child." In literature, the passion for romantic travel, so powerful in the 1920s, gives way to an equal fascination in the personal heroic quest of the agonizing man of action, as represented by such adventures as Saint-Exupéry and Malraux. Despite its philosophy of engagement, no form of literature demonstrated a greater revolt away from reality than the existentialism of young Jean-Paul Sartre and his fellow inmates of the Café Flore in the latter 1930s. In her autobiography, Sartre's mistress, Simone de Beauvoir, furnishes a revealingly honest chronicle of the attitude of French left-wing intellectuals. The autumn of 1929 had made her feel she was living in a new golden age. Peace seemed finally assured. The expansion of the German Nazi Party was a mere fringe phenomenon, without any serious significance. It would not be long before colonialism folded up. Of Hitler's coming to power in 1933, she writes, "Like everyone else on the French left, we watched these developments quite calmly." And in the same breath that she records, in passing, Einstein's flight from Germany, she deplores the closing down of the German Institute of Sexology. Still, there was no threat to peace. The only danger was the panic that the right was attempting to spread in France, with the aim of dragging us into war. To the elders of the left, as to so many of that generation, the memory of the 1914 to 1918 was stuck in their throats. In 1914, the whole of the intellectual elite, socialists, writers and all, no wonder Jaurès was assassinated, towed a wholly chauvinistic line. Our elders, then, forbade us to envisage the very possibility of a war. In their film going, this dread of war led Sartre and Beauvoir to miss Renoir's classic La Grande Illusion, by preference seeking escapism in such American farces as My Man Godfrey and Mr. Deeds Goes to Town. Political scandals. At the important elections of 1936, after Hitler's occupation of the Rhineland, Sartre had refused to vote. The political aspirations of left-wing intellectuals made him shrug his shoulders. Yet while regarding the French political scene with disengaged aversion, and finding nothing to stir my interest in the assassination of King Alexander of Yugoslavia and the French Foreign Minister Barthou, Simone de Beauvoir concedes at the same time that both Sartre and I read every word of the latest turn in the Stavisky scandal. This duality of attitudes extended far beyond the narrow circle of the Café Flore. Upon the futility of the Third Republic's political jungle had now become superimposed, though perhaps grafted is the better word, a miasma of corruption cases. The first big shock came in 1928 with the arrest of Klotz, the former Minister of Finance about whom Clemenceau had been so scathing, on charges of issuing dud checks. 2 years later, there followed the Oostenrijk scandal. Oostenrijk had built up a bogus banking empire largely propped up on vast loans somehow obtained from the Bank of France. When his empire crashed, the involvement of the second Tardieu government was sufficient to bring about its fall, too. But the greatest furor was caused by Serge Stavisky, the son of a Ukrainian Jewish dentist, a seductive young man with an apparently limitless number of useful contacts in politics, the press, and the judiciary. Already by 1933, his financial operations had come under official scrutiny, but he appeared to be immune from police interference, and a criminal case against him had actually been postponed 19 times. It so happened that the public prosecutor, who was failing to bring Stavisky to justice, was the brother-in-law of the current Prime Minister, Camille Choton. Then, suddenly, on the 30th of December, a major fraud concerning the issue of millions of francs, based on the assets of a municipal pawn shop in the small town of Bayonne, was pinned on Stavisky. The mayor of Bayonne, Garat, who was also a radical deputy, was arrested, but the indications were that much bigger game was involved. How else had Stavisky managed to pull off such swindles?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.